I can't do it. Okay. We'll do it live.
Okay.
Well, do it live! I'll write it and we'll do it live!
Time to rise and grind.
Are you kidding me? Holy on smoke!
And let's get this banter going.
It's bacon!
This is Snowman in the Morning.
Does anybody else feel like a fried egg?
And it begins now.
I want you to get up now. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs. I want you to get up right now and go to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell,
I think I just broke my chair.
He did what?
Has anybody ever told you you have a serious impulse control problem?
There is but one cause for me to follow. I'll murder the bum!
And here we go.
Oh, yeah!
Good morning. Welcome to the Thursday edition of Snowman in the Morning, and I'm still not at full voice yet, but I got some great stuff coming up for you. If you want to follow along with SNW Digital Media on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Twitter. I got the playmaker Darnell Solins joining me. Danny Thompson joins me for some great NBA chatter. Next Level Sports Talk finally makes its premiere. Trey Larkins and yours truly take an hour of your day and fill you with some great sports conversation and a lot of laughter. I can't wait for him to come on. But to start things off, I had a great conversation with one Cole Johnson. And you're going to hear that conversation in its entirety. And we kind of gave our thoughts on the NBA All-Star Game and All-Star Weekend in general. All right, folks. Now that we got all that out of the way, let me welcome that man in charge of Cole Sports to the program. This is Cole Johnson, and he joins me right now. How are you, sir?
Well, doing good. Doing good. How are you?
Aside of getting over a cold, I'm doing good, man. I'm doing good. All right, let's just dive right into this. I opened my show with my take on the All-Star Game and the format within, and I know I'm going to get a lot more pushback about me being old school. I know that, I understand that, and I don't care. Who the hell designed this All-Star Game format?
Well,
let's just start there.
Well, if you will remember, I'll let you get your question out.
You know how I think way too well. I mean, I understand wanting to bring an audience back to see the All-Star Game, because let's be honest, it ain't been since 2003 when you know who wore the original 23 and was in the All-Star Game. And I understand the death of Kobe. I get it. Trust me, I get it. Now, I understand one side wearing 2 in honor of his daughter Gianna and one side wearing 24, his final number in the league. That kind of pissed me off because no one honored number 8, his first number in the league. I mean, some of the players could have worn number 8, but I understand why they did what they did. I get that.
Mm-hmm.
But who in the vital blue, yellow-bellied, red-blooded hell came up with this format?
Well, for those who looked at, well, when you said when the All-Star Game was basically the All-Star Game circa 2003,
yes,
versus what we see now 17 years later, there was something called having team captains from each conference, and they can select whomever they want. And
right,
that was established in, I think it was 2017, I think.
Yeah.
After it was some consternation that, well, the West is dominating the NBA and the East absolutely suck it. Whatever team might be lucky, whichever team LeBron's on, and then everybody else.
Oh, you remember
so
that argument
too? They thought it was a talent disparity. Yes, I remember it but vividly. They thought it was a talent disparity between the West and the East, so they figured to make it competitively more balanced, they decided to make it a glorified pickup game.
And that's all they did.
That's why you have, yeah. And so that's what has resulted. So they tried this off for a couple of years. They still do it now. In fact, the All-Star teams that were selected was similarly selected as the two previous years. But what they discovered was these teams were scoring almost 400 points total. So it was like no defense whatsoever.
None
of which to speak.
None.
So it's like, okay, we have to make this interesting. So they come up with this system where if the team captain's team wins a quarter, that team captain gets $100,000 donated to the charity of their choice. So that's why you saw in the first, second, and third quarters, it acted as though it was a regular game that started in the first quarter because you saw they did three tip-offs.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
And then if that wasn't enough, then they decided to say, let's spice it up just a little bit more. You know that wonderful league that Ice Cube has with those who were playing basketball, they're not retired, but they still have a little bit of juice in them?
Yes.
Yeah, it's called the Big Three.
Yes.
Yeah, you know how the Big Three is. First team to 50 wins the game. You don't have a clock.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's the fourth quarter. So they decided on a point total, and it was the first team to that point total wins. And last night's point total was 157. So you have that as your all-star game format. And to a person like me, I totally abhor it because
it should be,
and I don't give a crap if I'm considered old school. Thank you. I appreciate the compliment.
Thank you.
The check is in the mail. It should be between the East and the West.
Yes.
Period.
Yes.
And it should not differ from that. Now, if they want to tweak with how they do what they do within the game, okay. But in terms of who gets on the court, it should be East versus West. It should not be whomever is the team captain on one end versus whomever is the team captain on the other end. No. And to me, it's not even working because you got LeBron, who basically is handpicking the best of the best, because you have Giannis Antetokounmpo, who is a principled man, is picking every asking player that's in the NBA first.
Yeah.
So how is this working?
How is this fair?
How is this working?
How is this working, number one? And number two, how is this fair? You know, and I absolutely abhor this format. I hate it. I absolutely abhor this format. For the same reasons you outlined, and you and I have spoken about this many times over, it should be East versus West, period. That's part one. Part two, you don't reset the score to 0-0 and have a jump ball. I understand if you want to keep them giving the team captains $100,000 toward their charity, I can live with that. I love that idea.
Yeah.
But keep the running score, will you please?
Thank you.
The running score, because how the hell is somebody that's walking into the second quarter know that it's the second quarter starting and not the first quarter because you have a jump ball at the first three quarters of the All-Star game?
Mm-hmm.
I hate that. And on top of that, I mean, a free throw to end the game? Really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The kicker was the fourth quarter is an untimed quarter. Why is that?
Exactly. Like I said, the popularity, you have to give props to Ice Cube and the Big Three, and I do.
Yeah,
that
I do.
League is catching fire.
It is.
Yeah, that league is catching fire. And it's a great league. It's a wonderful league.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a purpose. That serves a purpose. I'm with that.
Yes.
Because, one, you have a point total where they get to, which it's fine. You know, okay, so they play half court, and I think the first team 25 determines halftime, first team 50 wins. I'm good with that.
Yes.
I'm good with that. But for the NBA to adopt this in any way, shape, form, fashion, whether it is exhibition, all-star game, regular season, or the playoffs, no. No. They're supposed to be the best of the best for a reason. Why is it that they have to spice up or season up the product that is currently presented to us?
Because the product that's currently presented to us ain't all of that.
say it again for the cheap seats, please.
For those of you in the cheap seats at the old Summit or at the old Chicago Stadium, and I said this at the top of the show, the current product in the NBA ain't all of that. End of story. I've gotten a ton of pushback from the folks at work. And for those of you who know, my wife and I go to work early in the morning, then we come back and I hop on and do this show. I've said for years that the product has suffered. It has suffered. And it's suffering this year because, well, I hate to say it again, and you've said it with me on this program, no Splash Brothers.
I will continue to say this. Whether people love it or not, and they'll claim that they don't because it's their team that's not successful.
Exactly.
Any team that has a dynastic run, it is best for the NBA. I don't care who it is. Because you got to have the boogeyman that people want to root against.
Yep.
And you got to have the team that well, people may not follow the sport before the rise of this team, but they see this wonderful team and they connect to them for some odd reason.
Mm-hmm.
And they have more fans than they did before their run became national or international. And you have more haters.
Yes.
Because who hated the Warriors before 2015? Nobody hated the Warriors before 2015.
Nobody knew who the hell they were until they came right out of absolutely nowhere in 2015. I mean, they right got to the second round in 2013 against the Spurs, and the Spurs yeah beat them in six games. Mm-hmm. They go all seven right against the Clippers in 2014, and then 2015 in the first round. And then 2015 mm-hmm happened, and they run the table. And then all of a sudden, after 2015, and I'm going to get in 2016 here in a moment, and then all of a sudden, after 2015, the haters come out saying, how could they be this good that fast? They weren't due for another couple of years. Well, then the next year, they reached the NBA World Championship Series, out 3-1 series lead, and everybody wants to bring up how the Warriors choked a 3-1 lead. Newsflash, there was a hand in this. It was Adam Silver.
Flag on the play.
Uh-oh.
You mean to tell me You mean to tell me some idiot said to you that the Warriors out of nowhere just became a prominent team? So they just lost the all sorts of mind and fact that the leader of the team, even as we speak, was drafted in 2009. So we're just going to coat all that and just forget it.
Yep.
2009.
To the people that have pushed back against that theory that I just outlined for 2016, I get this pushback, and I know you've gotten this. Oh, there was no conspiracy. Cleveland was just better the last three games. Baloney. I ain't buying it.
Look, whether you want to believe in the conspiracy or not, The NBA filed up suspending Draymond Green.
Yes,
I mean
they did.
He actually did do a flagrant foul, which should have earned him a suspension the series prior.
Yes.
And he did not do a flagrant foul in the series that he gets the 1-game suspension from because he piled up too many flagrant fouls.
Mm-hmm.
And whether you want to say it's conspiracy or not, that's just wrong. Period.
It is,
but anybody, I don't care if you follow the sport or if you don't, for anybody to say that the Warriors just came bam, you snap your fingers out of the blue, they actually became contenders and champs. I mean, they were building this up since 2009.
Yes.
2009, Stephon Curry. 2011, Klay Thompson. 2012, Draymond Green. I mean, this was not an overnight success story.
But people seem to think it is.
And they took their lumps to the playoffs after that. So I'm like, no, this was not an overnight success story.
And they still seem to think it's an overnight success story, because had the Warriors not made the move to get one Andre Iguodala, who shut down LeBron in 2015, a person who is very underrated in my opinion. If they don't make that move, where are they now? They absolutely needed to get someone to really move them forward. And as much as I like to say that was Kevin Durant, that person was Andre Iguodala.
Durant didn't really move them farther. It basically just secured... It secured them at least two rings, in my opinion.
Yes.
It could have secured them three, but he got injured.
Yes.
But it secured it for him. I wouldn't say that they would. I would stop short in saying that they would not have won it sans Durant. Mm-hmm. I would probably argue you may have an argument 2018 with the Rockets, but we saw what happened, what they did without Durant in 2019.
Exactly.
So we could basically just erase that out of the equation.
Mm-hmm.
So, when you have a team like the Warriors, and you've had teams before them do the exact, I mean, it's the exact same formula. The exact same formula.
Mm-hmm.
Build a team up through the draft. Maybe find a couple of role players here and there from free agency and trades.
Yeah.
And then you build your team. And then you got your nucleus. Then you establish success. And then you get championship success. You want to keep that. So then you add pieces. Sometimes you look for those pieces. And in the cases of DeMarcus Cousins and Kevin Durant, sometimes those pieces come looking for you.
And this
I mean,
is what
the, wait,
this,
wait, wait, wait,
this
wait,
is
wait.
What people what, don't what understand.
The, what is what's a team? What's a team like a Warriors supposed to do? Just like, Kevin Durant comes to you and says, "Yeah, I want to play for you." But competitive balances, no, you don't need to join the team. Get out of here.
You know how ridiculous
that sounds.
You know what? I said after 2016, after the Warriors lost the championship, and I gave my conspiracy theory the next day on the air, and free agency was looming, the first statement I said during that program was that Kevin Durant will wind up in the Bay. 99% of the people who heard me make that statement thought I was absolutely stupid. And 99% of those 99% thought he would stay in Oklahoma City. And the reason I gave that he would not stay in OKC is named Russell Westbrook.
Ward number zero, yeah.
The exact reason I gave was one Russell Westbrook. I said, Kevin Durant wants to win. Russell Westbrook wants to pad stats. Okay, there's a huge difference between winning and stat padding. And Russell Westbrook was stat padding during the 2016 Western Conference Finals. Because if he was not stat padding during the Western Finals, they'd have closed them out in Oakland.
And should have.
Absolutely.
They should have closed them out game five in Oakland. But that team was not mature enough to do it.
They weren't built for it.
Just going to be straight up and honest. They weren't mature enough to do it. They weren't built enough and mature enough to do it.
And Billy
because
Donovan
They were talented enough to do it, but they were not mature enough.
They absolutely were talented enough to do it. And Billy Donovan didn't know what to do with Russell Westbrook. Are you kidding me?
Right.
I mean, you want to pray. Everybody wants to praise Russell Westbrook. Oh, Westbrook goes 100 miles an hour. Yeah, here's the problem. By the time the fourth quarter gets here, he's gassed. We've seen it the last 4 years.
Oh, and true to your statement about Westbrook, I mean, the last 3 years, triple-double for the season. So...
You know the back end of that coin.
He won MVP, so there you go.
You know the back end of that coin. Triple-double, 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 first round, first round, first round.
each year. Two times in five games, one game, in, 1 year in six.
Yep.
And, you know, and to me, when you have a guy who, you know, I think he spoke a little out of turn when he criticized LeBron James in his move in 2010.
Yep.
I think the rant felt that, okay, well, yeah, I get how you can you can boogie on teams, you can get your points, you can have your MVPs, but man, just hearing it from fans and hearing from organizations and hearing it from people who vote for Hall of Fame,
yep.
even if it is called basketball Hall of Fame, not pro basketball, not NBA,
right?
But even considering that, the rings do matter. And when you have that mentality, you know, you have someone like a Kevin Durant. It's like, you know what? Forget that I can score 28 points. I could do that blindfolded. I don't want to do 28 points and 10 rebounds or 9 rebounds. No, I mean, if I could do 25 or even less than that, but I get rings, I'll be happier.
You know who said that
now
same
two
thing?
Of them things.
You know so, who said that? You know who said that? Stephen Curry. Said the exact mm-hmm. same thing because he's been their leading scorer until Kevin Durant arrived. And Stephen Curry said, if I could take a few less shots mm-hmm. and we still win, I'm good.
Now, let's look at Curry. The year he won the MVP, the first unanimous MVP winner, I may add.
Yes, sir.
The league has been in existence now 73 years. Mm-hmm. He's been the first and the only unanimous winner for the MVP.
Yep.
He scored 30 points. He averaged 30 points that year.
Yes, he did.
30 points. You don't think that he wouldn't mind taking shots that he could take? No, he wouldn't mind doing that. But if there's someone who could take that load off, he's smart enough and he's unselfish enough to say, you know what? Okay. Yeah, bring your shots. I will shave some of mine. And if necessary, I'll come up and contribute. Until then, cool. Come on. Because all I want is championships. I could give a crap about MVPs. I got them.
Oh, not to mention, folks, that same unanimous.
Come on.
Right. Not to mention, folks, that same unanimous MVP 2015, 2016 only hit, 402 three-pointers that season, an NBA record.
That is ridiculous.
402.
Not attempted. Made.
Made.
The fact he made that many.
Yes. 400 three-pointers made. And then they welcomed Kevin Durant with open arms, and they were off to the races. And everybody mm-hmm. in Cleveland resting on their laurels. I hate to say this, Cavalier fan, but listen to a Snowman carefully and listen to Cole Johnson carefully. Y'all rested on y'all laurels. The Warriors got a little pissed off.
Here's the danger of doing exactly what you have just accused, and I say rightfully so, the Cavaliers circa summer 2016 are doing. So they get their championship. It's the first professional sports championship Cleveland has had in 51 and a half years.
Mm-hmm.
So they have this championship. They feel as though they have the best player in the world at the time. I'm not going to say that they're wrong, but there comes a time where you could say that and not exude it. There's a team in the same region that had success exactly two decades prior. I forget the team. It's like they border Lake Michigan. Mm-hmm. I think they're the third largest city in the country. They had the Sears Tower in there.
Yeah, that would
Soldier
be the
Field, Chicago Fame, United Center. What's that city? I can't remember.
I believe city
Chicago.
Is Chicago, my hometown.
They knew they had the best player at the time on their team. But did they rest their laurels? No. Nope. What did they do? They saw, okay, so Horace Grant bounced. Let's see how we replace him. Oh, Dennis Rodman.
Yep.
and you thought Scottie Pippen, even Michael Jordan would be like, yeah, we'll take him with open arms. No, they're like, Jordan was like, if he can help us win, cool. Mm-hmm. Scottie felt the same way, but Scottie was a little more honest. He's like, I really don't want this fool on the team, but look, if he's going to help us win, I'm cool with it.
Yep.
I mean, they didn't rest. It's like, okay, we got the number one man on our team, but let's see if we can build on this and make this train last as long as possible.
Which
the Cavaliers in 2016 thought that was it. And we got our team, Kevin Love and Kyrie Irving. Those will help out LeBron. And then we don't really give a crap about the role players. We don't need any role players. We're good to go as is. And then they got summarily stomped the next 2 years in the finals. Listen, so I mean, they were happy to be the Eastern Conference champs.
Mm-hmm.
But then when it got to June, they just simply were no contest for the better, more stacked team. And yeah, I will say the Warriors were more stacked. But you know what? I will also say, look at your history. Mm-hmm. Go all the way back to the early 80s.
Yep.
Name me a team that was dynastic, which wasn't stacked.
I can't name you one.
I can't name me one either. Every team that was from 1980 to now that decided to make a run, they stacked their team.
Yeah,
and it was to the point of we want to not just win, we want to stay champs. And you know what you got to do, the other however many other teams is in the league? Find your pieces. If you got to stack your team up too, and beat us.
Yep.
And if you can't, shut up and take your whooping like a man.
It's what Michael Jordan said. It's what Michael Jordan said after 1997, and he repeated it in 1998. Quote, we are entitled to defend what we have until we lose it. Period. Again, we are entitled to defend what we have until we lose it. That was Michael Jordan who said that. It wasn't LeBron who said that. It wasn't James Harden who said that. It wasn't Russell Westbrook who said that. Michael Jordan said that and said it proudly. Okay? Which brings me to this farce of an all-star game. And I have said it all day. All the folks at work were coming up to me going, man, Snowman, did you see the All-Star game? And I looked at them and I said, nope. And their mouths dropped. And they're going, why? Did you not see that? No. The All-Star game is a farce. And it's been a farce for a while. It became a farce when it moved. For me, the first point it really became a farce when it moved from national television to cable.
TNT.
And that, of course, was 2003.
Yep. How ironic.
That's when it became
the very last Michael Jordan All-Star game appearance.
The last one where MJ participated. The last one. And it's been a farce since then. Look at the team introduction since then.
And here's the thing. You now have a generation who sees the All-Star game on cable. Now, when we came up, when we were adults, it was on NBC. But when we came up, it was on CBS.
Yep.
CBS, Sunday afternoon. That was must-viewing. That was must-see viewing for people like us.
Mm-hmm.
And we got a chance to see our best, the best in the NBA, go at it. And it was on a huge national stage, and it was one of the big must-see events of the year for the NBA.
Yes, indeed.
But now it is reduced to a sideshow because I really do not believe it's because I'm older. It's just because, like you said, the product is different and not always better. It's to the point where I could bypass the whole doggone weekend if I wanted to, and I know I wouldn't miss anything. And that's not what I want to say about anything NBA, but that's exactly what I think, and that's exactly what I have thought the last few years. Now, I'll admit this. This year, at least Saturday, was a little more interesting, but that has been the exception rather than the norm. When we were teenagers, when we were in high school, that was the norm. NBA All-Star Saturday was lit.
It was.
And the All-Star game was as lit the next day.
You know what? So, the year that I keep coming back to that, you know, really highlighted the All-Star game for me was 1988. Why? A, Chicago Stadium. B, the slam dunk contest between Dominique Wilkins and Michael Jordan. see
best one of all time.
The 3-point contest where Larry Bird extended his index finger and it was at center court before the ball dropped in the bucket. And I'm bringing this up, and my wife's looking at me with a big old smile on her face as she's turning the dials for this program. And she just said, keep bringing them back. Keep bringing them back. Look. Aside of the Splash Brothers, we had shooters back in our day. Larry Bird, mm-hmm. Reggie Miller, Dale mm-hmm. Ellis.
Mm-hmm. I mean, just think about this. Bird, as much trash as he talked, that dude didn't get out of his warm-ups.
Nope.
He still had his warm-ups on,
and by the time he got to that last shot, and it was Bob Neal who did that, who mm-hmm. did the call on TBS.
Mm-hmm.
Soon as I heard Bob Neal say, for the money, and Larry Bird put his finger up and walked towards center court, and then you heard it rattle in.
I knew it was
in.
Going into.
Yep. Mm-hmm. How can you not?
Before winning, I knew it was going into. I was like, doggone, this man actually did it. And then what makes it even better, the stories you heard afterwards the players told about Bird, when he said, yeah, he came into the locker room, and he actually said to us,
who,
quote,
go for
who
it.
Is going to be shooting for second place? Because you know that trophy's coming home with me. Close quote. I mean, my God, I was like, that's brutal.
You know what? There's a Converse commercial that featured Magic Johnson, Isaiah Thomas, Mark Aguirre, Bernard King, and Larry Bird. Okay, and all I had to hear Larry Bird say was, you already know what they did for me. What? And he holds up a trophy. I walked away with the MVP. I walked mm-hmm. away from that TV and I said, damn it, he did it again. But before
we even called it mic drop, that's exactly what he did in that commercial.
Yep.
That's a doggone shot.
Yep, and one of his teammates, Kevin McHale, was in that commercial. You know he had to be laughing after they produced that thing.
Oh, yeah.
In terms of the All-Star game up to 2020, and it sickens me. And I said this earlier in the mm-hmm. program. It sickens me. And I'm going to get a lot of pushback for it, but bring it on. It sickens me that my hometown hosted that. And there was no soul. Aside of the tributes to Kobe.
Aside of the tributes to Kobe.
There was no soul this All-Star weekend. And to think, Chicago hosted one of the greatest All-Star weekends in 1988.
Well, you know the youngins are probably going to push back on you and say, well, what are you talking about no soul? You right. had Common who performed. You had Chaka Khan who did the national anthem. I mean, you had Chi-Town stand up.
You know something?
This is a big, big, big time for Chicago.
I met Common before he became Common at Chicago State University. Outstanding brother, okay?
Love the brother.
But the baseball fan in me, and I know I'm going to mention an old name, and I know y'all will appreciate this name. I will take the late, great Lou Rawls doing the national anthem before game 2 of the 2005 World Series between your Astros and my White Sox before some of these musical performances I've seen in the past for the All-Star game.
You'll never find another love like mine. Yeah, I love Lou Rawls.
Can I get a witness here? I'll take Lou Rawls doing the national anthem before a Chicago game. He defined Chicago, born and bred, a Southsider born and bred. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, I knew Common before he became Common, and he is absolutely outstanding. And he lives and breathes Chicago. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, after the music stopped and the game started, everything else stopped. Am I wrong for saying that? But this is how I feel. I saw 1988. I saw the roof come off the Chicago Stadium after MJ not once but twice leapt from the free throw line and smashed one down. Both of them got 50s, and both of them got him the slam dunk championship. Oh, and by the way, folks, you seem to forget, who was the MVP of the 88 All-Star Game? Michael Jordan.
Michael Jeffrey Jordan. Like I said, I consider the 1988 All-Star Game the Michael Jordan showcase, because that, to me, was the first, in my opinion, outside of commercials, that, to me, was the first time we all got a chance to see Michael Jordan amongst a room full of his peers.
Yes.
The guy.
Yes.
That was the event that made him the guy.
Mm-hmm.
No question about that. Not saying that he didn't do anything spectacular before that, because look,
right,
almost 2 years before, he put 63 on
in Boston
in the Garden.
In Boston.
So it's not that he didn't do anything spectacular before,
right,
then.
Right.
But that was the first big time showcase he had. And yeah, he won a slam dunk contest. You'll love this. In 87.
Yes.
And I think that one was in
Seattle.
the 1988 version of the All-Star Game, that to me was the Michael Jordan coming out party.
Mm-hmm.
Cause that to me was like, okay, you still had Bird in his prime, still had Magic in his prime. You had Isaiah about to get into his prime.
Yep.
And of course, each of those teams were the three teams to beat: the Pistons, Lakers, and Celtics.
Yep.
But this was an announcement to the whole basketball world that, oh, this number 23 from Chicago? Oh, so he's more than just a pitch man and a dunk guy.
Yep.
Oh, he actually can play.
It was the announcement.
We gotta look out for this dude.
It was the announcement of, here come the Chicago Bulls. Here comes Michael, right, and the Chicago Bulls. That All-Star Game, mm-hmm, 1988.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's why I always say that particular weekend and that game in particular, that was a trumpet sounding saying, yeah, there's a new sheriff in town. His name is Michael Jeffrey Jordan. And if you're not ready for it, you're going to get steamrolled by him. And 3 years later, the steamroll began.
Mm-hmm.
So that is what the All-Star Game is supposed to provide. It's supposed to provide those moments.
Yes.
That, yes, 1988 is that. 1991, when Magic Johnson came back and he announced that he was HIV positive in November.
Mm-hmm.
Then 3 months later, he comes back, not playing a single game in the NBA, and he just wows the crowd and just dominates the whole game.
And was named All-Star MVP. That was in Orlando, Florida. Now, I understand. I'll say it again, folks. I'm going to try not to sound callous, but I'm also going to throw some truth out here also. I understand why they named the All-Star Game MVP after Kobe Bryant. I get it. But I think Magic should have been named for that award first, for his 1992 performance.
Look, I'm a bigger Magic fan than I am Kobe. I will cop to that. Weeks posthumously after Kobe's passing, I will still say I'm a Magic Johnson fan before I'm a Kobe Bryant one.
Mm-hmm.
And it has nothing to do with what Kobe did off the court. It has everything to do with on the court.
Right.
And even with that, and yeah, it would have been a magical moment if they did that. But yeah, I'm with you. I get why they now call the All-Star MVP the Kobe Bryant Award. And it was more than, yep, just because this is a posthumous honor. I mean, mm-hmm, because the only other player that's won that award in particular as many times as he did, and people are surprised when I say it's not Jordan, it's not Kareem, it's not Magic, it's not Bird, it's Jerry West and Kobe Bryant. Those are two guys that have won that award the most,
mm-hmm,
out of every other player in the league.
Four times.
In the history of the game.
Four times.
So I, yep, get why they named that award. So I'm like, okay. And for that reason alone, I'm like, I'm not gonna push back on that.
No.
Like, okay. So yeah, give him that award.
I get that. Yeah.
I would say give Magic another one. That's, mm-hmm, why I don't push back on that one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. And that's understandable. And again, I'm not going to be totally callous. I understand why they named it after Kobe. All right. Yeah. I think Kobe would have enjoyed this version of the All-Star game. I know. As a matter of fact, I know he would have. But at the same time, the competitor in him would have roared. Okay? The
competitor, I don't think he would have liked that,
The competitor in him would have pushed all the way back against starting each quarter with a jump ball and at 0-0. That's when people like Kobe and MJ and Abdul-Jabbar and Magic Johnson and Larry Bird look at the scoreboard, go, oh, we're down 18? We can come back and get this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they take it as a challenge.
All the time.
That's how they were long before they were pros. That's how they were. That's how they were wired.
Exactly. That's exactly how they were wired. And the slam dunk contest, my God.
Let's get into it.
Let's
get into that.
Let's get into it. Okay. I will admit that, you know what? You and I had a broad sexual conversation off the air. And I'm going to bring it up on this program. I'm going to bring it up on this program, and I'm going to do it right now. There's a friend of mine who was a big-time bronze sexual, and he said something to me that, for lack of better terms, got on my nerve when he said, and I quote, Derrick Jones Jr. will have a better slam dunk contest and have more impact than Michael Jordan. Close quote. In four words, ladies and gentlemen, that pissed me off.
I only have, before I continue in words, I only have one thing to exhibit with that statement. Oh, Lord.
I knew you would get a kick out of that. I knew you'd get a kick out of that.
Oh, Lord. This fool almost made me cough a lung. Not you. That your friend. Oh, my gosh.
He nearly made me cough up a lung, and I was half asleep. I start laughing. I inadvertently woke up my wife, and she said, "What happened?" I'll explain later. I explained it. Listen, the next day we're getting ready for work. I explain, and she says, "All right, you got to tell me why you were laughing so hard. You woke me up." I told her. She looked at me and walked off.
That's even better.
She said, "Let's go to work after that." She said, "Let's go to work after that ridiculousness."
Oh man! I live in the southern state. So do you and your wonderful wife. So I think you and the missus will know the following words and why I'm saying it. But they have a saying in the South, and that would be "Bless his heart." And here's why I say bless his heart. Derrick Jones Jr., what anything is this guy has done anything that was significant? What significant anything he's done? And don't give me that he just won a slam dunk contest Saturday. Don't give me that. I said anything significant, like lead his team in scoring, like lead him to a playoff series victory. I'm not even talking about winning a ring. Just that.
He hasn't done a thing.
Well, Jeffrey Jordan, he wouldn't have much significance to Michael Jeffrey Jordan if you only reduced him to the 1985 season. Get out of here.
And by the way, folks,
I'll give him the rookie season of Jordan.
Yep.
And compared it to Derrick Jones Jr.
And by the way, folks, MJ took the then defensive team of the year, the Milwaukee Bucks, to four games. This is when the first round was five games. MJ and the Bulls took Milwaukee to four games. It took Milwaukee four games to eliminate the Bulls.
If you think you nearly coughed up along
after the Bron sexual fan statement, and I'll give you the floor in just a second, you're really going to cough up along when I tell you this, I didn't even know who the hell Derrick Jones Jr. was until he mentioned him to me.
The only reason why I knew the name, I can't remember the year, but I know he participated in the slam dunk contest before this year. That's the only, and I was like, okay, that dude's left-handed, and he normally does a tomahawk dunk. That's the only thing I really knew about him. That's the only thing I really knew about him.
But MJ has done left-handed tomahawks with more ferocity.
What exactly did
he do Saturday night that was so impressive? Can I get an answer to that?
All right.
What exactly did these dunkers do Saturday night that made people want to consider now this being the best slam dunk contest ever? Because I'll push back against that statement.
Well, the short answer is nothing. Okay, let me try to be as objective as I possibly can because I'm a journalist. Answer to that question is, I'll admit, I hadn't seen someone jump for the free throw line and do a windmill dunk. That's something that Derrick Jones Jr. did. However, that's not the best free throw line to goal dunk I've ever seen, because I can name two guys that have done it better. One of them, Jordan. Mm-hmm. The other, Mr. Julius Erving.
Thank you. And both did it more gracefully. And thank you. And by the way, the first time MJ took off from the free throw line for a slam dunk in the slam dunk contest, 1985, Indianapolis,
1985.
Indiana.
Yep. And he perfected it 2 years later.
Yep.
So, I mean, it was cool. I was like, okay, cool. An ode to the past. Well, I'm like, oh, that's kind of cool.
Yep. I get it.
There was another dunk he did where he was on the baseline. He did a between the legs 180, and he was spinning similar to the first dunk that Vince Carter did.
Mm-hmm.
When he approached the goal and he spun, but he spun basically to where he had to reach over his body to dunk.
But
similar thing with Derrick Jones Jr. That was the best dunk he did that night.
But the messed up part was the dude did
between the legs left tomahawk dunks almost all night long. That seemed to be the only dunk he did other than the free throw line to goal dunk.
You're talking
that was
about
a windmill.
The 180 that
mm-hmm.
Derrick Jones did. I remember a mm-hmm. fella named Vince Carter who did
yeah.
that. I remember
mm-hmm.
a fella named Jason Richardson who did it several times.
I do too.
Okay.
Underrated dunker.
Very underrated. I remember a fella named Desmond Mason, who played for the wait for it, Seattle Supersonics.
No, they're the Thunder now. But
you know how I feel about, and I know why you're laughing, because you know how I feel about this.
I'm with you.
In
bring a team back
eyes,
to the LNBA, you know better.
They're the Seattle Supersonics. And I made a statement on social media, and my friends mm-hmm. contacted me and they said, you're going to get in trouble. I'm like, bring it on. I said the next All-Star game, and now I know the next one's already been chosen. It'll be in Indianapolis.
It'll be in Indy.
And I know Indy will do it right. But
of course
the next one should be in Seattle.
Yeah. And look, before I continue, NBA, do it right. Get a team back in Seattle, name them Supersonics, because you know there should be a Seattle Supersonics representing the NBA.
Absolutely.
Period in the story.
There's the Seattle Supersonics, and I know the entire story, okay? I know the city of Seattle wouldn't build them a new arena. I know the argument that went on. I know a few fans in Seattle. I understand the back and forth that went on between Seattle and the NBA, and the Key Arena was very outdated. I understand that.
Yep.
My argument to the contrary is this. David Stern, you were the commissioner at the time. You were making money hand over fist. Couldn't you, like, slide Seattle some money and say, here, build a new arena. I'll help you build the damn thing.
And then you couldn't counter with the, well, the league can't really, they can't really influence organizational decisions. And then you think about Chris Paul's trade to the Lakers being voided because the league owned the New Orleans Hornets at the time. So it could have been done, because if the league could void a trade like that, then the league could probably pay
either
Seattle or King County.
They could have put a down payment on a stadium in Seattle.
Any type of money toward a new arena.
Mm-hmm.
Or they could have tried to refurbish Key Arena. I mean, something.
If you could knock down the Seattle Center Coliseum and reconstruct it as Key Arena in a short amount of time, you could knock down Key Arena, take a little loan from the NBA, and put up a new arena and make sure it's ready to go. It could have been done easy.
But you should not, and you could not punish. And I mean, you should not punish a city and a fan base as rabid as Seattle.
And they're still rabid to this day. I mean,
yeah.
Kudos to the Seahawks.
You can have any remnants of anything supersonic that comes to Seattle. Prepare to have earplugs. You will hear a deafening standing ovation.
That is
how devoted they are to the Supersonics.
I have a few games on my computer featuring the Seattle Supersonics, and I'm talking about from 84 to 93. Okay. A couple of them were against your Houston Rockets, but you know what? You take those at the time, because there was one game seven in the Seattle Center Coliseum. That was 1993. And then the game 6-2 overtime classic in Seattle in 1987.
Yeah.
Before the Sonics got swept by the Lakers. My point is this.
Right.
When you have a rivalry featuring the Seattle Supersonics and you have to stay up late to watch it, because remember, 87 CBS had the NBA contract at the time. You don't mind staying up late to watch that game, because you knew it was going to be a hell of a game. Especially Rockets and Sonics get together. I think it was two straight years or three straight years that the Rockets and Sonics got together in the playoffs. It was something else, man.
As a Rockets fan, I mean, the Sonics, in terms of competition, they were tough. Mm-hmm. They were tough, man. They were tough. However, the team, no joke, the team was respectful, and the fan base was respectful. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I'm saying the team was respectful, even with them in the 90s having someone like a Gary Payton who just talked endless smack. but the dude was still respectful, even against the Rockets.
Yes.
And I had then, even younger, and I was more invested in the Rockets and hating the fact they lost to any team. I then, and I of course do now, have tremendous respect for the Sonics. And I'm talking about the Sonics even way back to when they had Jack Sigma at the center.
Oh my God,
all
Jack
the way
Sigma.
To the Rain Man. You know, so
when
I have tremendous respect.
When I put that post up and said the next game should be held in Seattle, the first comment that came down said, and the team captains should be Gus Johnson and Jack Sigma.
Gus Johnson. God, I've heard that name
Gus
in years.
Gus Johnson.
Oh.
There are so many former Sonics. Man. There are so many former Sonics you can pick as captains. And I'll go just from the time I've watched them. Of course, we just mentioned Gus Johnson and Jack Sigma. You can have Tom Chambers on one side, Dale Ellis on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
You can have Xavier McDaniel on one side and Gary Payton on the other side. or Gary Payton on one side and Sean Kemp on the other side. Or how about this guard line? And you remember this duo from 87 when they played the Rockets in the playoffs. Dale Ellis on one side, Nate McMillan on the other.
Underrated point guard. Mm-hmm. Underrated point guard, McMillan was. Underrated point guard. Great handles and was a shutdown point guard.
Yes.
On defense. And people never talk about him like that. Never.
Nope.
But man,
Robert Reed found out the hard way about Nate McMillan, because McMillan
was tough to defend.
McMillan gave Robert Reed the business for six games in that series in 87.
Yeah. So when you talk to me about anything Sonics, as a Rockets fan, I have nothing but the utmost respect for them. Because
absolutely.
Man, they gave my Rockets the blues and then some often. But all I could do was just tip my cap and respect them, because they were just that team.
They just were
that team.
The Sonics gave the Rockets every piece of business, just like the Knicks did to my Bulls for 2 years before we eliminated them, 92 and 93. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, we saw them three straight years, 91, 92, and 93.
92 and 93.
Mm-hmm. I mean, when the Knicks got Pat Riley as a coach in 92, we knew we were in a fight. Mm-hmm. And I mean, the Knicks gave us the blues for 2 years, man. So the same respect that you have for the Sonics, I have for the Knicks and the way they were built back in the day. Okay?
Yeah.
I have the utmost respect for Pat Riley and the New York Knicks, the way they were built.
Yeah,
I've lost all kinds of respect now for All-Star Weekend. I've lost all kinds of respect for All-Star Weekend.
Here's the thing about that, though. And to me, this is what typifies why I do not like All-Star Weekend myself. So you asked a really good question earlier when you said, okay, name me a moment that you would say, this would eclipse 1988 or even 2016.
Yeah.
To just not regulate the old school.
Right.
Or 1986. And for those who don't know what 1986,
Spud Webb.
You had Dominique Wilkins, and you had this 5'7" guy who you didn't think could even reach the rim, but he reached it with ease in Spud Webb.
Yep.
And it wasn't a coronation in 2000 with Vince Carter, and you had some really good dunkers like Steve Francis and Tracy McGrady in that competition.
Yep.
But, you know, you didn't have those moments. Heck, even 2009, Nate Robinson and Dwight Howard. So you didn't have that type of moment. They tried to manufacture it.
How about 2006 with an underrated dunker? I believe his name is Andre Iguodala.
Mm-hmm. You know, so
find me the moment. Find me the moment. This past All-Star Weekend, when they really, and I'm going to give you this lob, okay? Let's go Larry Meshaw to Hakeem Olajuwon. Find me the moment during this All-Star Weekend where they really had a chance in game to honor Kobe Bean Bryant.
Okay, on Saturday, of course, you had Dwight Howard honor him, Superman jersey. He tore off the S, and it said 24 on where the S would be.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was a moment.
Mm-hmm.
The All-Star Slam Dunk Competition, man, one of them could have come up with that iconic dunk that LeBron James actually replicated. That would have been awesome. If someone came up with that dunk, that would have been the moment of the weekend.
Oh yeah,
game included.
Mm-hmm.
And the funny thing is, the moment of the weekend wasn't a slam dunk competition. The moment of the weekend was in the slam dunk competition, because you had Aaron Gordon, who you can argue he was robbed in 2016. I don't lean toward he was robbed. I would say if he got the trophy in 2016 instead of Zach LaVine, I would not argue.
Right.
But to me, it was that close.
Right.
You had a guy who dunked over a 7'5" individual.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you can argue, well, his leg on his way down clipped Taco Fall's head. Okay, fine. So don't give him a 50. But can you dunk over somebody 7 foot? No, I can't either. And to add to that, I've only seen one person do it, and that's the greatest dunker of all time, and that is Vincent Carter.
Yes.
That's the only guy I've ever seen literally dunk over a 7 footer.
And he did it in game.
I mean, he did it in game, cleared 7 feet. So I've only seen it once, and that was 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
20 years ago. That's how far ahead of his time Vince was. So fast forward to Saturday. You had this moment where you had a guy who leapt over a 7 footer.
Yep.
Because he still cleared him 7 feet. I don't care if you say, well,
he did.
Taco Fall ducked. Fine, he ducked. It still jumped 7 feet.
Mm-hmm.
The guy cleared 7 feet. A 7 foot man to dunk.
Yeah.
That was your highlight of the weekend. That was your moment of the weekend. And then you have the story of Gordon, quote, being cheated, close quote, 4 years ago. The committee had the moment, the judges had the moment where they could have righted the wrong,
righted the wrong
quote.
Yep.
And they could have given him the trophy. That would have been the moment of the weekend. What did they do?
They gave it to Derrick Jones.
They awarded him 1 point short, and they gave it to Jones instead. And I'm like, doggone it, you had the moment of the weekend. Because that was not going to eclipse the game itself.
No.
I'm sorry. It was not going to eclipse the game itself.
It wasn't.
I mean, the game wasn't going to eclipse that in that moment. You had the moment of the weekend, and you ruined it.
And they blew it.
You blew it. You ruined it.
And when you told me that, that helped me lead off my show this morning. I led off part of my show this morning when I did my Snowman's take with that particular moment. I mean, y'all, you had a chance to really put it down, and you didn't. And you didn't.
Because that was the moment of the All-Star Weekend.
Yeah, it was.
That was the moment.
Yeah, it was.
And they had it handed to him with a silver platter. They could have given him a 49. If they gave him a 49, that still would have been good.
That was ball game.
Yeah, ball game. Because to me, I was thinking, he cleared a 7-footer?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, game set and match.
He cleared the tallest man in the league. 7'5" Taco Fall. He cleared him.
Yeah.
He cleared him.
How the heck you clear the tallest man in the league and you don't have him win the competition? That blows my mind. So I'm like, man, if you all who are inside baseball, or in this case basketball, you can't see that's a moment that you've got to savor and you have to put and you have to promote.
Absolutely.
Then you have failed as a whole organization.
Yeah, you did.
Because that was the moment. The crowd didn't cheer any louder in any portion of the whole weekend than when that dunk happened.
Yeah.
That was your moment.
That was.
And you ruined the moment.
They ruined the moment.
That was your moment.
And that
right there is a microcosm as to why people do not take the All-Star game seriously. Because you have shenanigans like that happen.
Yep.
One too many times.
Way too many times. Way too many times.
Man.
And I'll never be a fan again until they get it correct and actually put on a game that's actually worth watching. And they take it off of TNT and bring it back to either CBS or NBC. Get those four evil letters out of the equation, NBA.
Well, to be fair, the All-Star Week, ESPN does do some of it, but they don't do all of it. Because the main focus is on TNT. So the ESPN does the celebrity game. They do that.
Oh,
but TNT does the rest.
That farce. Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Who puts the celebrity list together? They held that at Wintrust Arena Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
Who put the celebrity list together? Because of Darius Miles, Stephen A., and Michael Wilbon, and yes, there was a Horace Grant and Nate Robinson sighting. They were Bulls favorites.
Right.
I don't know who the hell half these people are.
Quentin Richardson. I knew who he was.
Okay, Quentin Richardson, like, yes. Oh, I've met Quentin. I went to high school with his sister, and I had a chance to interview him in 1998. Quentin Richardson, yes. Okay, I'll take that. I'll take him off the table.
Mm-hmm.
Who the hell are these other people?
I would seriously not be surprised if ESPN/Disney picks the list, because I just don't know if the NBA is all that invested in saying, well, yeah, we want this particular celebrity, or we want the celebrity list to be like this.
You know when they did it right?
I'm like,
you know when they did it right? They had the old timers game, and they eliminated it.
Now that I loved.
Yeah. They eliminated the old timers game. Now, I loved watching the old timers game because when I really first started getting into basketball, it gave me an idea of who the guys were that preceded the guys I love. I get that.
Right.
I get that.
Yeah. It deepens your love of the sport, and it's supposed to.
Yep.
Right.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. It absolutely does. It absolutely does.
Mm-hmm.
They need to bring that back. Can we see a Kareem Abdul-Jabbar skyhook one more time? Can we see Reggie Miller suited? And Dr. K, this one's for you. Can we see Reggie Miller suited up one more time wearing the blue and gold of the Pacers and have him crank one from 25 feet? Can we see
after
that?
After he runs a curl to do it?
Yep,
yeah.
After he runs a curl off a screen from Dale Davis or no, I got one for you Indiana Pacers. You're going to love this name. Can we see Chuck Connor's person launch a couple of threes from distance?
Oh, man. That brother there.
Can we see Chuck Person hit a couple of them? Can we see Vern Fleming bring the ball up? And, yes, I'm paying absolute tribute to the Pacers and my beautiful wife because I used to watch the Pacers back in the
day. Oh, my gosh. Vern I haven't seen that Fleming. Name in decades.
Vern out of Georgia.
I was barely in high school when I saw it. Oh, wow.
Vern Fleming. All right.
Wow, you really dusted off one that I haven't heard in a long time.
Can we see Rick Smits drop a hook over somebody's head a couple of times?
Man, underrated center. Underrated.
I love the Duncan Dutchman. Love the Duncan Dutchman. Can we get a replay on the big screen in the United Center of Reggie Miller's 8 points in 9 seconds? I know they play it at Bankers Life Fieldhouse. And I'm familiar with Bankers Life Fieldhouse and how that screen is. You play that next year. This is what they need to do next year in Indy, which is where the All-Star game is. It'll be at Bankers Life Fieldhouse. They need to queue up that clip of his 8 points in 9 seconds.
Oh, man, that was...
Have Mark Boyle and Slick Leonard add their radio call to it.
Boom, baby.
When I was covering Marquette Catholic, I used that phrase for 2 years. I did. I used boom, baby, for 3-point goals for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
they need to have that in Indy. And you know, so I asked a friend of mine, you know, where it was going to be held. He said Bankers Life Fieldhouse. You know where my brain was going. Lucas Oil Stadium.
Mm-hmm.
You know where my brain was going. If they can have it in the arts, if they can have it in the Hoosier Dome, as it was called back in 1985, they sure as hell can put a floor in Lucas Oil Stadium. They do it for the NCAAs. Done it twice already.
Oh, yeah, I was about to say more than once.
They've done it twice already.
In that stadium.
In Lucas Oil.
Yeah, but not just in Indy, in that particular stadium.
In that particular look, they had it at the Hoosier Dome. They've had it the Hoosier / RCA Dome twice, and they had it at Lucas Oil Stadium twice.
You mean to tell me
there won't be enough interest for them to put some extra seats on the floor at Lucas Oil Stadium? And put about 80,000 people in there. If they can do it in Dallas, they can do it in Indy.
Mm-hmm. Now, see, that to me is a great indictment against the All-Star Weekend.
Mm-hmm.
If you, as the highest level of professional sports in your field, you can't pack or you don't feel as though you can pack a, I'll be on the conservative side, 80,000, because I think it would probably be 80,000 seat stadium. Yeah. But the Final Four in the NCAA can, and you know they could pack it for three games.
And they always do.
That should tell you the All-Star game is messed up. That should tell you right there the interest level or lack thereof in the NBA All-Star.
And there's a point I mentioned earlier in the show. You can pack 70,000 people into Lucas Oil Stadium on two occasions for three games and have over 200,000 people attend those three games, and you can't pack 70,000 into Lucas Oil for one?
Once. Once. Just do it one time. Yeah.
That's
an indictment against the All-Star Weekend.
Yes. I agreed. You mean to tell me that the year they had it in Dallas, I think it was 2010, their original plan was to have it at American Airlines Arena, but the interest was so out of control, they had to move it to what's then called Cowboys Stadium at the time.
That's right.
You mean to tell me that on a last-minute move, you can pack 110,000 into Cowboys Stadium, and you can't even begin to open the floodgates for Lucas Oil and put 80,000 people there? There's your answer about the lack of interest in the NBA All-Star game, that you feel you don't have the ability to pack Lucas Oil Stadium, one of the most popular stadiums, not just in the Midwest, but in the country.
Yep.
It's held a Super Bowl. It's held two Final Fours. And you can't put the All-Star game in Lucas Oil Stadium?
And it's not like they don't know how to hold events on an annual basis. They hold the Combine every year there. So, I mean,
the Combine draws people, okay?
And you would think it wouldn't. And that draws people. So, yeah.
One side of the stadium, I understand, is closed off because they have everything on the near sideline. But at the same time, that's the side that's open is full. The side that is open is full. And you mean to tell me that you can't put 80,000 people in Lucas Oil Stadium for the NBA All-Star game? And I understand Bankers Life Fieldhouse can put 20,000 in there. I understand that.
I understand that.
But have the but one corner of that place is going to be roped off because of the doggone introductions. Because of the screen that's going to be used. I mean, that's gotten more WWE than anything else.
You stole my thunder, because that's exactly where I was going to go. I was like, so to me, I think the NBA goes the wrong route, because that's exactly what I think. It's like, I think they want to fancy themselves as the WWE, and they want to have like a big old Titantron. But instead of just having them play clips of people, they just play clips of people, and that's where they have the players be introduced and walk out. And I'm thinking, you don't need that.
You really don't.
You don't really need that. You don't have to set it up like it's a concert. You don't need that.
If they can pack the Kingdome, here I go referencing Seattle again, but think about how true this is. If they could pack the Kingdome in Seattle with 40,000 people and not need a Titantron setup for the introduction of the players, you would think they would draw upon that and not go through all of the rigmarole setup to bring the players out. But since 2004, since 2005, I want to say 2005, they've had this ridiculous introduction set up. It's ridiculous.
And it goes for when the Astrodome hosted in 1989. It goes for when the Alamo Dome in San Antonio hosted in 1996.
Yes.
You know, it goes for those two instances where you had these big time stadiums, and at least 50,000 people were packed in those stadiums.
Yeah.
And you did not need to have that elaborate concert stage that lights up as an LED board behind you if you're standing on the stage.
Yes.
For a presentation. You didn't need that.
Right.
And you don't need that now.
They really don't. They really don't. I mean, you would think that they'd learned their lesson. I mean, Madison Square Garden, 1998, and I'll close with this, and I know y'all have enjoyed this conversation. Believe me, when one day happens, when Cole and I get the same day off, I'm just going to hit this recorder and we're just going to go, and it's going to be a podcast episode. 1998, it was at Madison Square Garden in New York. They didn't turn the spotlights off. They didn't turn the house lights off then. They turned the spotlights on, and they had the players walk out from their respective locker rooms.
Perfect.
They had the they had the dancers, they had a band playing. Yeah, that's about as far as they went. But at the same time, when you had some of the players that you had back in 1998, Kevin Garnett, Kobe Bryant, of course, Michael Jordan, Tim Hardaway at the time, you don't need anything else, man.
No. I mean, the event is called All Star.
Yep.
So to me, that gives me the impression that the star is the player. And if the star is the player, that should be the focal point of the whole event.
Mm-hmm.
So why is it that there's other elements that are introduced to not make the star or the elite player or the superstar player to dare be the focal point of this weekend?
Dare I mention Drake? 2016.
Yeah. Dare I mention Drake?
Because I mean, I understand him being an ambassador for Toronto. I understand that. He was a big time ambassador when the Raptors won the world championship. I get that. I understand that. I'm cool with that. But at the same time, you have Drake doing the introductions.
And ridiculous. And it leads me to my greatest gripe about All-Star Weekend. So the slam dunk competition itself is a sore spot for me.
Yep.
And why is that? You mentioned it earlier in this interview. When you said, who the heck is Derrick Jones Jr.? That is what we have been saying for almost the last 20 years when it comes to this event.
Yes.
Why is that? Because you have bench players on that stage instead of starters. And the reason why the event was so popular was because you had the greatest players in that time performing these feats in that event.
Yes.
Who wants to I like Aaron Gordon. I got respect for him.
Yes.
But seriously.
Absolutely.
Who wants to see him? Who wants to see Derrick Jones Jr.? Who wants to see that? Who wants to see them?
I'll repeat my question I said earlier. I'll repeat my question I said earlier in the hour. Who the hell is Derrick Jones?
Right.
Who in the vital blue hell is Derrick Jones? And why?
And that's.
And I got to get. You know what? You need to do me a favor. You need to send an email to this Bronze Sexual fan, and you need to do it now about Derrick. I am totally. Look, we've gone off the rails here, folks. I may as well bring this part into it, too, because there's one more subject I have on tap. We'll get to that in a moment. But you need to send an email really quick to this Bronze Sexual fan, if you would, sir.
All right. Okay. All right. If you so inclined. All right. All right. Here we go. Email Bronze Sexual fan. CC. All Bronze Sexuals. Subject of email. Idiot. Body of email. Okay, sir. So, Derrick Jones Jr., he of the Heat. Same height as Jordan. So we're talking about a shooting guard slash small forward for the Heat. Was with the Suns. Is supposed to have the impact similar to that of Michael Jeffrey Jordan. What gives you the impression that he could do that? And I say that in all honesty, because I'm dealing with a guy who his best season was last year. He played 60 games. He started 14. He only averaged 19 minutes. And he scored. I'm sorry. It's just hilarious to me when I hear people say scored 7 points on average with 4 rebounds. And, oh, okay, steals 2, less than 1 steal a game. And this is the guy you prop up and say he's going to have a bigger impact than Michael Jordan. Come on, man. Look, I will not even insult Michael Jordan in comparing him for the rest of his whole career. I'll shorten it to 1. And the 1 year I will shorten it to is 1985. I'll shorten it to that. Here's a guy who he averaged 38 minutes. He started all 82 games. A novel concept. A guy who actually starts to play 82 games in a regular season.
Yes, for yes, an NBA. Yes.
He averaged 28 points. 28.
Mm-hmm.
Pulled down 7 boards. 6 assists to boot. I'm just shrinking it to his rookie season.
Yep.
85, his rookie season. And the stats I just said for Derrick Jones Jr., that wasn't his rookie season.
He's been
in the league 4 years. And you mean to tell me this guy has more of an impact? You're saying that will have more of an impact than the guy who off the bus from Dean Smith.
Mm-hmm.
Gave you 28-7-6? You were smoking something, son. Come on. Look, you all just simply want... Yes, I'm addressing it to you, Mr. Bronze Special fan and all Bronze Special fans. You all do your best to try to denigrate people like Michael Jordan just to boost up number 23 of your heart. To say, this guy is better than Jordan because, well... Jordan didn't do all this. I just gave you his rookie season. Mm-hmm. 6 years before he hoisted up his first Larry O'Brien trophy. And people would literally kill to have stats like the which I read for Michael Jordan, his rookie season. So in closing, let me say this. You need to gather perspective, son. Derrick Jones Jr., he couldn't carry Michael Jordan's bags. He's not even worthy to do that. He might be worthy to maybe lick the heel on Michael Jordan's sneaker. Don't say anything blasphemous like that ever again in life. Because Derrick Jones Jr. in his 4 years doesn't even measure up to Michael Jordan in his very first. Doesn't even measure up to Michael Jordan in his very last year. I'll even give you that. 26-4, I'll give you that. His last year in the NBA was better than Derrick Jones Jr. Nah, son. Miss me 100% with your misguided, this guy will have more impact than Michael Jordan take. It is off base. And you may need to go to the optometrist and get your eyes checked. Cole Johnson, Cole Sport, withaz.com, part of the Snowman Media, digital media network.
Bravo, sir.
Oh, good Lord.
This is Snowman in the Morning. Where true sports talk lives.
He did what? out.
I did not need to be told that.
Well, you guys have heard my take on the All-Star Game throughout this week, and I want to thank you for tuning into the show. Somebody got mad at me for my take, and he said, you know what, Snowman? I said, what? He says, I have to defend the new school. I said, really? He said, yeah, you're going to let me do it. So I'm going to let him. My good friend, the playmaker, Darnell Solins, now joins me. What's going on, my friend?
Nothing much. And those are the playmakers this week. This is good.
Now, what did I say wrong in my assessment of the All-Star game?
I wouldn't necessarily say what you said wrong. I just felt like you and Cole were bashing the All-Star weekend this year a little too much. Just a little too much.
Really? Why? So of course you realize I'm going to have fun with this. You do realize?
Oh, I know. I know. The only person I'm missing is Cole.
So what?
I'm pretty sure he'll have a ball with me too.
If we don't have fun with this, then we're not doing our job. All right, man. Let me have it. Lay it out for me.
All right. So, number one, as you and Cole admitted, y'all didn't pass this in the All-Star weekend. That's first and foremost. So, by y'all not paying attention to the All-Star weekend, they did keep a running score for the All-Star game.
No, they didn't.
Yes, they did.
I know they did.
They did keep a running score. They, even though they had the score at the bottom of the second, the whatever quarter it was, and you started to score. If you looked up at the top of the screen, you would have saw the total score.
My question is, what the hell did they do that for anyway?
So that everybody knew what was going on. I'm pretty sure somebody heard Snowman talking about, why are you restarting the score? Why you can't keep running the score? Somebody must have heard you and was like, you know what?
You know
they
what?
Got a spot at the top of the screen.
You know what's bad?
The total score.
You know what's bad? I had about 10 people at work tell me that. They heard that and they said, look, did you look at the top of the screen? No. Why didn't you look at the top of the screen? Because I was trying to find the radio call. And they start laughing. So what else do you have to defend?
I agree with y'all when y'all talk about the slam dunk contest. What y'all failed to mention
is,
in the whole scheme of things, the three judges that gave that dunking nine on Aaron Gordon, Scottie Pippen, my dude Chadwick Boseman, Black Panther.
Who?
And most importantly,
Dwayne Wade.
Dwayne Wade.
Who was the second person you said?
Chad, you know, Black Panther.
Okay. So, why did Aaron Gordon get robbed again? Unfairly, I might add.
So apparently, they didn't say who, but one of the judges said somebody changed it. It was supposed to finish in a tie.
But so,
somebody said they need to pick a winner. So they had to come back and pick a winner. And doing so, you allow somebody like Dwayne Wade to, you know, hand the trophy over to a Heat player.
Should have known. Because I was not impressed by Derrick Jones. I'm sorry.
See, that's not the thing. The thing is, Aaron Gordon had straight 50 until that last one.
And it's that, and that should have been a 50.
How does somebody get 50 throughout the contest and lose?
Well, it happened Saturday night. Does that answer your question?
I mean, it was just, that was Tyree Rogers.
And while we're touching on the weekend, go ahead.
the 3-point contest. I heard y'all, and even though it wasn't star power for the 3-point contest, yeah, you could say adding the Mountain Dew balls might have been a little too much. But if you look at how the NBA played, those guys, that's what they normally shoot.
So back them up to the distance already. You don't need the Mountain Dew balls inside that contest.
But you have to admit what Buddy Hill put on a show when I did that.
Boring. I've seen better.
Oh, we all seen better. but if you look at it, like, come on. Now.
He did. But
yeah, both of y'all coming from him.
But see,
y'all coming from the aspect of Chicago 88.
You gotta remember,
like 20 years later.
You gotta remember, I'm old.
I've seen some good stuff. I gotta come on here. I gotta bring them towards the new school way, because if you look at from the 90s to now, that was one of the best all-star weekends we had in a long time. By the way, TNA did get a check as expected on Friday night.
You saw that too.
That's the only reason I was looking. I'm like, Stephen A's coach. Oh, I can't wait to see this. And they did not get Stephen A a team whatsoever.
Well, you know, they set it up that way. Who was broadcasting the game?
ESPN.
I rest my case.
They chose Robot over Stephen A. Smith.
That was once again. Who was broadcasting the game? Come on, say those four letters for me. Who was broadcasting
ESPN.
The game? I rest my case. You know they were going to cheat Stephen A. And I mean this jokingly. They're already paying him like 10, 12 million bucks, which is going to be my salary in a couple of years. And yes, I'm putting it out there right now.
And both of y'all deserve it.
I appreciate that. I really appreciate that. Hey, I want to give Cole Johnson a piece of the pie also, and you a piece of the pie also, man. It's time for some new school sports talk with the old school flavor coming back in. All right?
Ooh, I like that one. I definitely like that one.
You know, I always say for my company, 21st century media with a 20th century feel, when people really listened in, you know? That's the flavor that I want. Speaking of flavor, let's get to some questions for the second half of the NBA season. Here's my first one, and I know you're going to have fun with this. Will Ben Simmons ever make a jump shot?
I can't remember what game it was, but he made some. But, yeah, He'll probably make it.
Okay, let me change my question. Will Ben Simmons make a jump shot consistently?
Hell no.
Exactly the answer that I was looking for, sir. More to the point, will Joel Embiid ever make a consistent jump shot?
The better question is, would Joel Embiid stay healthy enough?
You know what? That is a better question. Will Joel Embiid finish the season? There's a question for you right there. Will Joel Embiid finish the season?
Probably not. Maybe go ahead and take a page out of Kyrie Irving's book, because Kyrie Irving don't look like he's trying to come back.
You know what they're going to do? Listen. Joel Embiid's not going to finish the season. While we're asking questions about the Eastern Conference, let's go to this one. Will Kyrie Irving ever get it together for his career? Because since 2016, he's fallen flat on his face.
Be honest, I think he is. I think I know what the Knicks and Kyrie Irving are doing.
Really?
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, it's good to play now, but they know who's coming back next season.
If he comes back.
Oh, he's coming back. This dude's already shooting, and he ain't missed a start. He ain't missed a beat yet. I'm looking at this dude like, okay, well, wait till we get to the physical part. Then we'll know. And I'm pretty sure knowing Kevin Durant, he'll be ready.
So you think Kyrie Irving's just saving himself for when Kevin Durant comes back?
Oh yeah, don't nobody want to admit it, and why would you? But yeah, they saving it.
This is why I love having you on, because you break stuff and I break stuff and no one believes us until they see it happen. 4 years ago, I correctly predicted Kevin Durant would sign with Golden State, and people called me crazy. And guess what happened?
Yeah.
So when Kevin Durant does come back, and Kyrie Irving decides to get his head out of his ass, are they really a conference contender?
Top four.
Top four, huh?
Top four. They might struggle in the first part of the season.
I don't think
they get that group together.
I don't think so. I don't think so, and I'll tell you why. Durant's never played. And I'm going to say a couple of things that people are going to get mad at me about when it comes to the Nets, but I prefer speaking the truth, and I prefer putting it out there and saying it the way it needs to be said. Kyrie Irving is still a head case right now. What makes you think, and I want an honest answer to this from you, what makes you think that Kevin Durant's appearance in a Nets uniform is going to calm him down and set him straight? I want an honest answer to that.
What happened in 2016?
So you're comparing Kyrie Irving to Russell Westbrook?
What happened? No.
So how do you think Kyrie Irving
had a front row seat of watching Kevin Durant destroy him and LeBron?
Well, we all know that. And he's going to have another front row seat when the Warriors destroy him again.
Kyrie was a one-time champion. Kevin Durant's a three-time champion.
I don't trust him. I'm sorry. After 2016, I don't trust Kyrie, healthy or not.
The only thing Kyrie needs to do is set up. That's it. Because once he's on the court, he is a show.
Bah. He was once upon a time. Bah. But I am willing to see what happens. So we shall see what happens. Between the Boston Celtics and the Toronto Raptors, who gets out of that? Who gets out of that matchup?
I like Boston instead.
Okay. We'll see. Now let's move to the West. Okay. A lot of people are not going to like this question, but I'm going to go ahead and say it. Do the Lakers actually have enough of a team to get to the Western Conference Finals, let alone the World Championship Series?
Hold on. So you said people ain't going to like this question, right? Those who would do that to you, they haven't been paying attention to the news. There's a point guard who was just released from Detroit by the name of Reggie Jackson, and it's going to sign with the LA Clippers.
My question's about the Lakers.
What makes y'all think the Lakers gonna have a shot against the Clippers?
They don't have a shot against them now. There's the point.
They already had Paul George. They already had Kawhi Leonard. Even before they came there, they already had Patrick Beverly.
Mm-hmm.
They already had Lou Williams. They already had Harold. Now you're going to add Kawhi Leonard, Paul George to that team, and now you're going to add Reggie Jackson to that team?
How is Reggie Jackson going to fit with the Clippers?
Reggie Jackson gives them another point guard. So anytime when you want to give Patrick Beverly a rest and not have Lou Williams, you know, do most of the work and just feel like a shooting guard, a scoring guard, there's Reggie Jackson. And by the way, if need be, Reggie Jackson can take over the game too.
I like. We'll see what happens. That's the playmaker, Darnell Solins, joining me to talk some post-NBA All-Star game and get ready for the second half of the season. Thanks a lot, my friend. I'm going to invite you back because we're going to talk some college basketball, too. But thanks for coming on, man.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. I'll be ready for that.
Well, I hope y'all are ready. We got some more stuff coming up for you after this.
This is Snowman in the Morning.
Holy on smoke!
Where true sports talk lives.
I like him. He's silly.
Okay, folks, I've had some great guests on the show in the 6 years that I've been active in hosting this show. But this gentleman that I'm about to reintroduce to you guys, I had him on once, and that was a mistake because I should have had him on a lot more times than now. So much was going on with me off the mic. And then, you know, just recently I got married, moved to North Carolina. He and I finally are getting together to give y'all an education on the NBA. He is the host of Beyond the Buzzer and also the Around the Association podcast. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my good brother, Danny Thompson. He joins me right now. It's good to talk to you, my friend. It has been a while.
Mr. Snow, it's a pleasure. And yes, it has been a while, but we're not, you know, after this conversation today, we will not make this a long-term not speaking again.
We won't. We won't. I mean, he paid me a great compliment before we came on, and he said to me, you know, it's good to see you come from nothing to be where you are now. And I say this to you, A, thank you, and B, we still have a couple of mountains to climb because there's some stuff that we need to do, and I truly appreciate your words.
Hey, you know, the thing is, though, it's always uplift. You know, we always try to uplift one another no matter the situation. And the thing is, respect remains respect, and iron sharpens iron. So, we always have to uplift and motivate each other, and because we're all trying to do the same thing. We're all just trying to do this for a living and what we love to do. So,
yep.
I love it.
And I love it also. All right, man. I have picked on you mercilessly for many years now. This poor guy, I've picked on him, you know, when he spreads his, you got to go check out the Around the Association podcast. I'm a faithful subscriber and listener. I love the podcast. I tease him mercilessly when it comes to the subject of the NBA because, A, I like teasing him, and B, he usually knocks me down about five pegs with his knowledge, which is why I brought him on. And, you know, we tease each other. We're brothers on the microphone. And, man, again, it is great to have you on so we can get some NBA chatter going. I truly appreciate it.
Let's rock it, bro.
Let's rock it indeed. The second half of the season is here. And what I want to do, I want to pull some questions about some teams. And we'll start in the East. One of the teams that has been ballyhooed all season long, but in my eyes hasn't gotten to that level yet, is the Philadelphia 76ers. Here are my two reasons. Lack of a jump shot for Ben Simmons, lack of health for Joel Embiid. Your thoughts?
I wrote about this I posted an article about this on the website around the association yesterday. The Philadelphia 76ers are the Jekyll and Hyde of the NBA this season. And I say it this way, because at home, they are a monster. They're 25-2 at home this year.
Right.
But they're 9-19 on the road. It's one of the biggest differences in the NBA. And when I say differences is because they win by about 10 points a game at home,
and they
lose give
up by
10 more points a game
on the road.
On the road.
for
Sixers fans.
You would think they would be playing at the old Spectrum in Philadelphia the way they are at home. You'd think they'd be back at the Spectrum.
The crazy thing, they have a better home record than the Milwaukee Bucks, who is on pace to win 70 games this year.
That's frightening.
So the Sixers, the good news for Sixers fans is that acquiring Alec Burks and Glenn Robinson III will help the bench. The other good part is they're now going to bring Al Horford off the bench, because when they traded for Al Horford, it was one of the most head-scratching moves of the entire summer.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have two guys Now, mind you, Horford's a great passer, mm-hmm. but Horford doesn't stretch the floor like most stretch fours do.
Yes.
So it didn't seem like it was a great fit. And yes, you're right. Ben Simmons still hasn't developed a jump shot. We're still 5 years into this, and it's still not happening. I don't find it happening soon. The one thing with the Sixers is that they can get themselves in a playoff series. They match up very well with Boston. Mm-hmm. They match up very well with Miami.
Right.
They can mess with Toronto now because Toronto doesn't have Kawhi Leonard. If they end up with with Milwaukee, it's see you later.
Yeah,
they have no answer for Giannis. And I'll say this: the other part with the Sixers that's scary is that they miss Jimmy Butler more than you would think.
Well, yeah,
because Jimmy Butler is a closer. Just like in the movie Boss Baby, ABC always be closing.
Mm-hmm.
The Sixers don't have that guy. And as much as I love Tobias Harris,
he ain't that closer.
He's not a closer.
He's not a closer.
He's a good ball player. But he's not a guy that I will sit here and say he will put fear in me at the end of games. And that's why the Sixers cannot get past maybe the second round or even the Eastern Conference Finals, depending on the matchup.
I don't see them going past the second round. I mean, the hell with the Eastern Conference Finals, unless Ben Simmons decides to become a closer like everybody's making him out to be, I don't see him getting out of the second round. I don't see it.
Josh Richardson better start hitting jump shots in the fourth quarter. That's all I'm saying.
Jeez, and y'all thought I was bad with some of these takes, okay? But it's truth, though. If you watch, it's truth. Now, I move to this question as we stay in the East. What the hell is wrong with Brooklyn? The AKA New Jersey Nets.
Well, let's do it this way. You know, Brooklyn, if you had the high expectations with Brooklyn when the season started, you're going to be highly disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not because of Kyrie Irving, because your best player is coming off the most debilitating injury in the history of the NBA that has conquered more players than we can think of. And, you know, Snowman, you are an old school. You know, you're an old school fiend.
Yes.
The only player that ever survived the Achilles is Dominique Wilkins.
Dominique Wilkins, yep. He went to play
in 94.
Yep. He played five more seasons after he came back from that injury.
And he averaged 30 points a game the year he came back.
Yep.
He's the only player to survive and become the player he was.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not looking good for Kevin Durant. So if you're expecting the Nets to do anything major this year, you should have been sadly mistaken. Now, Kyrie Irving was hurt the entire season. He hurt his shoulder early part of November, and now he took cortisone shots and will have to have surgery if he's not already had it. The Nets have a problem right now. And it's not because of Kyrie Irving. The Nets knew they weren't going to be no more than a 7th seed anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the Nets' job is to basically avoid, and just like the Orlando Magic and other teams in the East, if you make the playoffs, avoid the 8th seed. At least if you're at 7, you have a fighting chance to win a game or two in the playoffs. Because if you run into the buzzsaw up in Milwaukee, you're going to get destroyed in the first round.
Forget it.
It's a first round sweep.
Forget it.
Brooklyn now has a very interesting question in the offseason. With Kyrie Irving and Kevin Durant coming back, okay, fully healthy, what to do with Spencer Dinwiddie? Spencer Dinwiddie, be honest with you, before Kyrie Irving returned to the lineup, was an all-star.
Mm-hmm.
And he is a guy that can give you 20 points a game, and he plays with so much. He plays hard every night.
Yes, he does.
Now, when you get Kevin Durant coming back, you get Kyrie Irving coming back, you have Caris LeVert. What to do about Spencer Dinwiddie? That's the real question.
Yeah,
it's not like if Brooklyn's going to do anything in the playoffs. Let's be honest; they're a first round snack.
Yes,
they're going to be a first round snack for anybody with or without Kyrie Irving. And I love Kyrie. It.
He's a first round snack.
They're going to be a first round snack for whoever they end up with in the playoffs.
I know it. Oh my Lord, I got to use that now. First round snack. I bet you my wife's going to get a hold of this phrase and she's going to use it on me one of these days. I absolutely know that's going to happen. Let's stay in the East, shall we?
Trademark, by the way.
Okay.
Let's go.
Okay. Let's stay in the East. Boston, Toronto. Do either one of those two get to the World Championship Series?
Both of them. Actually, no. The funny thing is we looked at Toronto when the season started. You're thinking they lost Kawhi Leonard, they lost Danny Green. Okay, they're going to be not so good. Kyle Lowry missed a whole bunch of time, and then Pascal Siakam might even be the most improved player for the second consecutive year in a row, which is almost unheard of.
Yeah.
Then there's a guy who was hitting big shots in the finals last year who took into Kyle Lowry's role, and that's Fred VanVleet.
Fred VanVleet.
The Raptors are the only team in the NBA that has built their team with guys from the G League and undrafted free agents. If you look at Keel guys' rotation, you look at VanVleet, who wasn't drafted. Pascal Siakam was a late first-round pick that was part of the G League team. You look at Chris Boucher. You look at Terrence Davis. You look at Norman Powell. If you want to go back and see how good the Raptors was, look at the team that Jeff Weltman and those guys built with Masai Ujiri.
Yeah.
Go back to Raptors 905, which is their G League team that was coached by Jerry Stackhouse. That was the most dominating G League team in the history, I think, of that entire league. The Raptors, are fine. They're just, like the Boston Celtics, they're a matchup situation. Is the further you get away from Milwaukee and the longer you have to get to them, the better chance you have of getting to the conference finals.
Gotcha.
Boston has all the talent. The problem with Boston is that do they have enough rim protection? There is no Al Horford. There's no Aaron Baines.
Right.
Robert Williams has moments. Enes Kanter can't guard a can of paint. But Enes Kanter is good for a double-double. So that means you're relying on Daniel Tice and a whole bunch of other guys. Jason Tatum is a monster.
Yes.
Kemba Walker is perfect in the situation.
Yep.
Jaylen Brown could be an all-star for almost any other team.
Mm-hmm.
And Gordon Hayward is back to being Gordon Hayward.
Yes.
The Celtics have everything, and Brad Stevens can coach one of the best OT after-timeout guys in the entire league.
Yes, he is.
Both of them are contenders. The longer you stay away from Milwaukee, the better.
So you think Milwaukee can actually get over the hump this time?
There's one team, and I'll say, I know you might think it'd be crazy, that should scare the Milwaukee Bucks in the playoffs.
And that team
without looking at the top brackets, the Indiana Pacers.
Yes. Yes, 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 yes.
If Victor Oladipo rounds into form, you have Malcolm Brogdon, who was basically given away by the Bucks.
Yeah.
And there's nothing better than a playoff series than a guy who has motivation. We've seen this in every sport possible. The weakness of the Milwaukee Bucks, ironically, is their $18 to $20 million point guard, Eric Bledsoe.
Right.
Bledsoe has been eaten alive in the playoffs by point guards the last couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
How did Terry Rozier get a $58 million deal from Charlotte? Go back to 2 years ago when Kyrie Irving was hurt, and Rozier became Scary Terry in that Bucks series.
Yep.
Eric Bledsoe's a very good point guard, but he gets eaten alive in the playoffs.
That he does.
It happens.
That
and
he
you
does.
Have Malcolm Brogdon, you have you have Oladipo, you have T.J. Warren, because when T.J. Warren scores over 20 points, I think the Pacers are 17-3 this year.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say, well, I think I wrote about it on the website. They have Sabonis, who was an all-star, Miles Turner, who's one of the better rim protectors in the league, and don't forget about Aaron Holiday and Jeremy Lamb.
Right.
The Pacers can give the Bucks all types of fits.
Yep. They can give them the blues. They can really give the Bucks the blues.
They're dangerous.
Yeah.
But Oladipo has to round the form. Oladipo has not shot the ball very well. He's relying too much on that 3-point shot.
Yeah.
He's got to get his mind. And I know it's difficult coming off that injury. It's been 12 months. He's going to have to get his aggression back. We got 6 weeks.
Yeah.
If he gets that aggression back by early April, and the Pacers can get out of round one with a second round matchup with the Bucks,
it's on and popping. It's on and popping. With Indiana, and I'm really pulling for the Indiana Pacers. I got quite a few reasons. A lot of them are old school reasons, but I'm really pulling for the for the Indiana Pacers. Final question on the Eastern Conference: Who gets that number 8 spot?
The question is, who really wants the 8 spot? because here's the thing: I was writing about it on the website for the so you're down to about maybe 3 or 4 teams in that 7-8 fight.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Brooklyn's got the advantage. Orlando's at 8. Orlando's 3 games in front of Washington, who's also right in front of Chicago.
Yes.
The thing is, Orlando has one of the easier schedules down the stretch.
Right.
The problem with Orlando is that Evan Fournier has been really good. Vucevic is pretty much doing the same thing he did last year, but Terrence Ross is still playing from 2 years ago.
Right.
This is not the same Terrence Ross that was finding and hitting everything.
Yes.
Markelle Fultz has been better than advertised.
Mm-hmm.
The Magic don't have their best defensive player. Their 2 best defensive players are out the rest of the season. There's no more Jonathan Isaac the rest of the year. Don't expect him to come back. Al Fulcamino has been out since November.
Yeah.
The Magic right now are playing a situation where Aaron Gordon is playing basically power forward, and they're going to have to start James Ennis because Wes Iwundu and whoever they put at small forward is not working because you have to keep Ross coming off the bench because you're running out of firepower. On top of that, the Washington Wizards, ironically, have a good chance of making the playoffs. But if you're the Wizards, do you really want to make the playoffs?
The
Wizards,
Washington,
they're three games behind the Magic.
You mean the Washington Bullets or Wizards?
Listen, the team that used to play in Landover. There's three games behind the Orlando Magic right now for the eighth spot in the playoffs.
You touched my heart with that statement. You touched my heart with that statement, bringing up the old Capitol Center.
Yes, the old Capitol Center with the old Bullets jerseys, watching Rasheed Wallace and Chris Webber play together.
Chris Webber, where John Thompson would roam when he coached Georgetown.
Yes. But no, but to be honest with you, you got Bradley Beal, who's still mad about making the All-Star team, averaging 29 points a game. Davis Bertans has basically proven the fact of he's more than just a system player in San Antonio. Mm-hmm. He's one of the best three-point shooters in the league. Rui Hachimura has played really well. Thomas Bryant. They've gotten guys who can play the game. Washington could sneak in if Orlando can't find ways to score the basketball.
True.
Orlando's the worst scoring team in the NBA.
Yep.
The thing is, and the one thing that Steve Clifford had his hat on was defense. The Magic's defense is not the same as it was last year. They have to go on a run. The other team that's in the race is the Chicago Bulls, ironically. I know you're all hometown Chicago Bulls.
Yep.
As bad as the defense has been, as many injuries the Bulls have, they're within five games of the Magic. Okay, you can't.
And they can get on a run. They have the tool. It's just the Bulls have been.
Help.
Yeah, they got to get some help. They got to get some help. It's the Bulls have been so beat up. Yeah. They've been so beat up this part of the season up until the All-Star break. Oh, my goodness.
I think Carter's missed 20 games. Marcus missed about 10. They're without Chris Dunn. Otto Porter's been gone since the 10th game of the season. So they've missed a lot of guys this year.
Yeah, they have.
Now, and here's the thing. Chicago, Washington, is it really worth potentially losing a top five pick, because the way the lottery set last year, you can finish anywhere and end up potentially high with a high draft choice. Is it worth it to go on a run and become a first round snack once again for the Milwaukee Bucks? I think it's going to be Brooklyn. I think it's going to be Orlando.
Yeah,
but it wouldn't shock me if Washington caught Orlando, because outside Chicago, the rest of the teams in the East aren't going to do much damage, because Clint Capella is going to be out for an extended period of time in Atlanta. And there's a dumpster fire going on in New York, dumpster fire going on in Cleveland, and a dumpster fire going on in Detroit. And Charlotte, Charlotte can't seem to get themselves out the way of the fourth quarter. They play good for three quarters, but somehow can't keep things together in the fourth quarter, and they're not consistent. So that's your Eastern Conference, pretty much in a nutshell.
And Zach LaVine beat them with a buzzer beater in Charlotte earlier this year.
Yeah, but that's also the same game that the Hornets had a 10-point lead with 4 minutes left in the game. They're used to it.
Oh, they had a 10-point lead with 65 seconds left. They had a 10-point lead in that game against the Bulls with 65 seconds left, and the Bulls caught them and passed them, thanks to Zach LaVine.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay?
Zach LaVine turned to Reggie Miller. I understand. I'm a diehard Hornets fan when I'm not covering the league. It is what it is. I'm used to it.
I love it. All right, let's go to the Western Conference. And I'll begin with this question. And it's a question that people hate asking. Hell, people at work hate me asking this question, but it's a true one that needs to be posed. Do the Lakers have enough to get to the Western Conference Finals, let alone the World Championship Series?
Yes. They have even with the point guard situation not being where it is, and the Lakers not having a consistent outside threat that scares you. The fact of LeBron James and Anthony Davis, let's just say they're the best duo in the league. I mean, even better than the duo that shares the same building. The only difference is that the Lakers need Kyle Kuzma to do something and find himself. The Lakers do have a wild card. DeMarcus Cousins is back practicing and getting himself in shape with a potential return in April. If DeMarcus Cousins can come back in some shape or form, he's not playing heavy minutes. Dwight Howard's been playing well, and they have JaVale McGee. But Cousins gives them another weapon. The Lakers better hope they can find somebody in the next 12 days that can either help the point guard situation or find a long-range shooter. maybe a J.R. Smith, maybe Dion Waiters. I know those aren't really, really scaryful names, but it's just depth.
I'm sorry.
The Lakers need all the help they can get.
You had me laughing mentioning J.R. Smith. The last time he played with LeBron was 2018, and we know how that turned out.
Listen, but you know, but J.R. Smith provides something the Lakers do not have enough consistency of. Is a guy who can knock. I mean, as much as we laugh at J.R. Smith for the timeout, and we laugh at, you know, other things J.R. Smith does off the court, wearing no shirt on a regular basis, that's fine. But when J.R. Smith is dialed in and he's actually on the court, J.R. Smith is a lightning rod. When he hits a jump shot or two, he's one of the more dangerous shooters in the league. I'll be honest with you. If I'm the Lakers and can't find a point guard, there's one sitting in Seattle right now that is clamoring for a job. His name is Jamal Crawford.
Yeah.
Someone needs to go make that phone call.
I still think
they're famous to win the whole thing, actually.
Somebody needs to make a phone call and say, hey, bring back the Seattle Supersonics. But then I digress.
Go get the arena first.
Yeah, I know. Quit reminding me of that. Just let me dream for a couple of moments about the return of the Seattle Supersonics. Who's the Lakers snack in the first round? Who gets that number eight spot? who becomes a snack for the Lakers in the first round of the West playoffs?
I don't know if it's a snack because the Memphis Grizzlies are really good.
Yeah, that they are.
But the Portland Trail Blazers are starting to get their health back. Yusuf Nurkic and Zach Collins are due back sometime in the first couple days of March. If the Blazers get those two guys back, it's going to basically strengthen a rotation that's very thin outside of Hassan Whiteside.
Yep.
You get Collins back, you get Nurkic back. Even if they're not playing heavy minutes, the fact that it's able bodies.
Mm-hmm.
We all know how dangerous Damian Lillard is.
Yes.
And CJ McCollum.
And they've missed Nurkic. They have missed Nurkic.
Even though Whiteside's been really good, better than advertised.
Yeah.
They're not very deep on that front line. They had to use Kyle Lebeser. They had Tom Dedue's rookie Nazir Little at that four position. Carmelo Anthony played a lot of the four. He played really well.
Yeah.
The thing is, without Zach Collins on the floor to grab rebounds and hit jump shots, and Nurkic being able to be a bully in the paint, you put Nurkic and you put Whiteside together as a duo.
Yeah.
Collins and you have Carmelo at the four.
Mm-hmm.
The Blazers become much deeper. They acquire Ariza. I think they got Ariza as well too.
Yeah.
The Blazers are starting to get home. If they're within three or four games of the Grizzlies, they can make a run at this because Damian Lillard is the difference between the Blazers and the Grizzlies. Is that as good as John Morant is, he's not a superstar. Damian Lillard is. There becomes the difference.
Yeah, there is a difference.
Also, don't sleep on the New Orleans Pelicans. They're five games out, but the Pelicans are getting healthy.
But how far can Zion carry them? There's my question. My question lies with Zion. How far can he carry them?
I think it's not about the fact Zion carrying them, it's how much can Brandon Ingram carry and Drew Holiday carry them.
Gotcha.
You know, Zion's going to be that guy, but Brandon Ingram's an all-star. Drew Holiday was considered to be an all-star. The Pelicans have a lot of things to concern themselves with,
mm-hmm.
but you have to. One thing you have to realize is that, and I know, Snowman, you're all about numbers. You're all about, like, trends.
You know how I am.
The Pelicans are going to have to start winning games, but here's a magical number for the Memphis Grizzlies. It's the number 20. The Grizzlies are 17-1 when Dylan Brooks scores 20 or more points in a game.
Really?
They have beaten the Rockets. They've beaten the Jazz. They've beaten Denver, and they've beaten the Clippers this season when Dylan Brooks has scored 20 points. If he gets 20 points down the stretch, like the old saying, law is law, it's flat. Like when the Clippers get to 100, first team gets to 100, it's mm-hmm. a wrap.
Okay.
If Brooks gets to 20, by rule, the Grizzlies are almost unstoppable. And the thing. As long as Bill Brooks is scoring, the Grizzlies will maintain eight, but Damian Lillard is too dangerous. So I need to know when Nurkic and Collins is coming back. If it's early March, then I think the Blazers got a shot at this. But otherwise, it's Memphis is going to be a first-round opponent for the Lakers.
Last question. How big of a dumpster fire is it in Houston?
Houston's not a dumpster fire. Now, I'll tell you this for the reason being. when they acquired Damari Carroll and they acquired Jeff Green a couple, within the last 48 hours, it's now the point where I wrote it, and my article's coming out tomorrow about this. It's about, okay, who's the backup center? Because PJ Tucker is a starting center right now. The backup center right now, I guess, is going to be, I guess, Jeff Green is going to be Damari Carroll. I don't think they're going to dust off Tyson Chandler, and Hartstein is not going to make much of a difference in the playoffs. Yes, it's going to hurt they didn't go get somebody with a little bit more size. It wouldn't shock me if they went and got Kenny Freed over the next 10 days to do something. It's not a dumpster fire, because the problem is, for every team in the West, with the exception of the Dallas Mavericks, who is going to be able to outshoot the Houston Rockets in the playoff series? Especially if they're hitting shots. If Harden and Gordon and Covington, if they're all hitting shots, Austin Rivers. You know, I'm even saying Austin Rivers in this. I'm really, like, scaring myself. you have all these guys hitting shots.
Snowman, only one team. Yeah, you know how you scared yourself? You said if. You put the words if and Rockets in the same sentence.
Listen, we've seen more interesting groups with the Rockets before, and they've gotten deep in the playoffs.
True.
The Rockets get the right matchup. Let's say they end up with Utah in round one. They can outshoot the Jazz in round one. Because the thing is, if you're spreading the floor, that means you're not really trying to deal with Rudy Gobert, which takes away the Jazz's best weapon on defense. That means you're making Donovan Mitchell and Joe Ingles and those guys have to defend on the perimeter and deal with James Harden. You can beat the Jazz in the first round series. Okay, yeah, let's just say you end up with Dallas in the first round.
Right.
Dallas is the only team in the NBA that can shoot with the Rockets. Dallas is the NBA's best three-point shooting team. Mm-hmm. They have four guys that average over two three-pointers made a game. Mm-hmm. You got four of them. Okay? That's a different matchup. Can they beat a team like Denver in the playoffs? Unless Gary Harris can find himself, Denver can't go past. Gary Harris has been bad this year.
Yeah, he has.
Denver has every other piece to be a team in the finals. You have an all-around stud at center. You have a lead guard that's not scared of the moment in Jamal Murray. We saw him in the playoffs last year.
Mm-hmm.
He took his game to another level. You have veterans who are interchangeable that do the little things, and Paul Millsap and Jeremy Grant and Plumlee. You got a sharp suit. You have a human torch off the bench and Will Barton.
Right.
The only thing they're missing is Gary Harris is one of the best defenders in the league.
Mm-hmm.
Gary Harris has to hit shots.
True.
If he's hitting shots, then Denver is dangerous in the playoffs. They can beat the Clippers. They can beat the Lakers in the playoff series. But Gary Harris has to hit shots.
Yeah.
And that's going to be the difference between Denver making the finals and being eliminated. But, yeah, the team, like I said, I'm looking forward to in the playoffs. I want to see what Luka does in Dallas. But that's another story for another day.
We'll talk Luka next time. Man, thank you so much for coming on to the program. This is Danny Thompson. Check him out, folks, Around the Association podcast and Beyond the Buzzer. And I think I'm going to have to throw my spider webs and yank him in each week for some more NBA conversation if he's interested. I'd love to have you, man. I would love to have you.
Oh, we'll get the schedule together, brother. It's all rough.
We will get it together. Thanks a lot, my man. Appreciate the time.
Always.
Well, there's more coming up in a flash.
This is Snowman in the Morning.
Holy on smoke!
Where true sports talk lives.
I like him. He's silly.
Well, folks, I'd like to introduce a little something we like to call Next Level Sports. To help me out with this, and you will hear him every week on this segment, I welcome Trey Larkins of Wise Guys to the program. How are you, my friend?
Pretty good, brother. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Good to have you on. And we had a chance to talk before we started this. And this Houston Astros thing has got you really pissed off.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. This situation with Houston Astros, Brian, I've been very, very frustrated about it because I really feel like MLB Commissioner Rob Manfred hasn't handled it correctly.
Really?
And I don't understand. Yeah, I don't understand why he hasn't completely stripped the Astros of the 2017 title and taken their rings from that World Series. Like, I believe that Major League Baseball has completely botched this Astros scandal. And the fact that they disrespected the integrity of the sport, and I'm listening to all these interviews. Yeah, all these multiple players on these interviews and the arrogance that Astros players are talking and saying is just very disrespectful to me. Like, I don't like it. I just think they're very arrogant. And the owner for the Astros, Jim Crane, he came out last week and he had the nerve to actually say that the scandal didn't impact the actual game. And what happened? Like, are you serious? Are you kidding me? Like, what are you saying? Because when you look at the World Series over a two-game span, the Dodgers, they gave up 18 runs, 26 hits, and 6 home runs.
Mm-hmm.
And Jim Crane had the nerve to say the scandal didn't affect the outcome of World Series. It made no sense to me.
Well, how can you prove that it did? This is the only time I'm going devil's advocate, because the Astros did cheat and they did get caught. Yes. All right. I am not saying anything to the contrary of that. I understand how you and quite a few other fans are feeling, including Dodger fans, and I'll get to the Dodgers in just a moment. But would it fix anything? Bad word. Would it correct anything if they were to strip the Astros of the 2017 title and take the rings away? Your thoughts?
Yes. I feel like overall that because they cheated, they shouldn't be crowned as champions. You know, I also don't believe there should be an asterisk next to their name in the record book. I just believe they shouldn't be crowned as champions. Their rings should be revoked because they weren't suspended going into next year. They're not going to be missing the playoffs. You know, he already said they could still go to the postseason. So there's nothing that's going to be affecting them next season. So you, at least at the bare minimum, you have to strip them of the crown and also strip them of their rings because they aren't suspended. They didn't lose any money. So,
well, that's why they didn't get suspended. Well, that's why they didn't get suspended. It would hurt MLB's bottom line, because now you got to look at it this way. Now you have that team that you really love to hate outside of the New York Yankees, but that's the Yankees. That's another story. But now you have that team that you really love to hate, and you've got the reason for it. So none of the players are going to get suspended unless Rob Manfred really grows a set, and I don't think he will. And says, you know, anyone who was on that 2017 Astros team, you're banned, and they work a ban out, you know, over the course of, I'd say, 3 years. How would they work that out? That's my question. I have so many questions about this. How would they work out a ban? And in a way, I agree with you that the championship should be vacated and the ring should be taken away as well. But in another way, the championship was decided on the field.
Yeah, I agree. I understand that, but it was decided, and they had a decisive advantage because they knew what pitches were being thrown. So because you know what pitches are being thrown, that's part of the reason why the Dodgers pitchers, Brandon Morrow, Clayton Kershaw, Hugh Darvish, they look absolutely terrible in the World Series. And they and now we know why.
Well, Clayton Kershaw gets embarrassed in the playoffs anyway. We can go back before 2017 and talk about that. I mean, he got embarrassed against the Mets. The Mets of all teams in the division series. As a matter of fact, if you look at, and I brought this stat up before, and you agreed with me on this, if you bring up Clayton Kershaw's last, I can't think of the word right now. If you bring up Clayton Kershaw's elimination games since 2015, he's 0-4. He's lost 3 of those at home, and he lost to teams he should not have lost to, including this past year with Washington.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. We've known Clayton Kershaw to not show up in the postseason.
Yes.
It has happened numerous times.
Yes.
Yeah. So I agree with you about that.
Right.
Overall,
right,
we're on the same page with that. Clayton Kershaw, overall, as a pitcher in the playoffs, he folds under pressure.
He's horrible.
Time and time again.
And I understand where you're going, but if you go back to 2017, And I understand that, but at the same time, you know, that part of it can you can just attribute to Clayton Kershaw's inability to throw the correct pitch at the right time. Just ask Howie Kendrick.
Yeah, I agree with you. I just think overall, when you look at the Astros, I just think when you look at the Astros, Brian, I just hate their arrogance in that situation. Mm-hmm. And overall, they don't care. They're not showing any kind of remorse because the title wasn't vacated from them, so they could care less.
Yeah.
This was a collection of Astros who was guilty in a situation. They should all suffer, players included. And like I said, I do not understand for the life of me why the hell Jim Crane, the owner for the Astros, got up there and had the nerve to actually say that this scandal didn't affect the outcome of the World Series. I believe it affected the entire outcome. Now, again, I don't believe that the Dodgers or the Yankees should be given the World Series title by any stretch.
Right. Thank you.
I believe it should be vacated away. Yeah, it should be vacated away from the Houston Astros. They're cheaters, and they just have to pay for this scandal and for this situation. And like I said, it just messed up the entire integrity of Major League Baseball.
No argument there. And this is coming from a guy whose first love was baseball, so no argument there. Now, to these Dodger fans, and you and I know a couple of them mutually, we all please shut the hell up about we should be awarded the World the 2017 World Series. Yes, the Astros cheated and it wasn't found out until 2 years later, but you got to say this. When it came time to clinch a series on your home field, you got your ass kicked. Period.
Yes, I agree with you there. I agree with you about the Dodgers overall as a team. I felt like the Dodgers blew the World Series as well.
Yes.
Now, I'm not saying, listen, we know the Astros cheated.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
The Dodgers also played a part, and they collapsed in the World Series. And again, like you said, the Dodgers had a chance to win the World Series in L.A., and they didn't get it done.
Nope.
So, like I said, a part of me feels like the Astros cheated, and we know that has come to pass.
Yep.
It's true.
Yep.
But the other part of me feels like the Dodgers, they had a complete choke job in the World Series in 2017.
But
they shouldn't be awarded the title either.
But it's the Dodgers. Who the hell is surprised? Let's be honest. Who?
Exactly.
I brought this stat up since 2014. You've ridden with me for the length of time, you know, that this show has been on. I brought this stat up. Since 2014, the Dodgers have lost every elimination game on their home field. 2014 against the Cardinals, 2015 against the Mets, 2017 against the Houston Astros in the World Series, and 2018 against the Boston Red Sox, that was also the World Series. And this past season, they lost to Washington when they led 3-0. So the Dodgers didn't earn the doggone title either. They fold under pressure, and they've done it every single time they've gotten to an elimination game.
I agree with you. I agree with you completely. So that also was a whole separate thing in of itself.
Yes.
I agree with you. I think Dodger fans need to shut the hell up. I don't think they deserve a title either. The Yankee fans don't deserve it. The Dodger fans don't deserve it. And
Thank
the Astros damn sure don't deserve it.
So Thank
I think,
you.
I just think it needs to be vacated completely. There shouldn't be a champion in 2017. And like you said, in previous other seasons, the Dodgers always fall under pressure. And
yep.
even when they have the advantage of having home field advantage,
yeah.
they still somehow come up short.
And you can't explain away the Dodgers choking away a 3-0 lead in Game 5 of the Division Series against Washington. And then Dave Roberts, who I felt should have been fired 2 years ago, leaving Joe Kelly out there to face Howie Kendrick and then throwing him a pitch in his sweet spot? Really?
Yeah. I agree with you. And that's another thing. Dave Roberts has had a lot of questionable decisions.
That's
as
an understatement.
For the Dodgers. Yeah, he's had a lot of questionable decisions as manager for the Dodgers throughout this time that they've been competing for a World Series. So
mm-hmm.
I agree with you overall, Brian, about that.
Man. My partner's Trey Larkins, the host of The Wise Guys. You're riding with Trey and Snow on Next Level Sports. Our discussion starting with the Astros and how Trey feels that title should be vacated. Now, I did have a list of things that we were going to talk about. I'm tearing it up because we're going to go off the mark here. because we're going to just pick at each other for a little while, because there were some things that Trey has said and I have said back to him, and people thought that he and I were actually arguing. Here's what I mean. How many times have you said something about Aaron Rodgers and I've jumped on you?
Multiple times.
How many times have you said something about Aaron Rodgers? And after the NFC Championship, I read your post on the air, and you know, I just broke down the stats of the NFC Championship game. And I was one of the first people you reached out to before the NFC title game, saying, "Here comes Aaron Rodgers. Here comes Aaron Rodgers. Oh yeah, well here comes Nick Bosa in return. Doggone it."
Yeah, and it definitely happened, man. I got to say, look, before the NFC Championship game, I had made a post. I'm going to be honest, Brian, I was psyching myself up to actually believe that we had a chance against the Niners. Because, you know, early, I'll admit it. Because, you know, earlier in the season.
You got your ass kicked. 37-8 in the Bay.
I got to admit it. So I'm guilty.
Right. And I had to pounce. I had to pounce after the Sunday night game. I had to pounce when you wrote a post immediately after the game, something to the tune of, "That's okay. We will see you again." And I think I responded something like, "Y'all are going to have nightmares if you see us again, because we're not even healthy."
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, here's the thing, though. The week of the NFC Championship game, Brian, you've seen this post. Mm-hmm. I know you've seen it. I went on Facebook and I made a post and I said, "Hey, we got Jimmy Graham. They got George Kittle.
Right.
We have a more proven tight end than George Kittle. Yes. I know George Kittle is better than Graham." I just said Graham was more proven.
Right.
I also said, we got the Smith brothers.
Yep.
We got Matt LaFleur.
Yep.
In his first year, he led us to a 13-3 record. They got Kyle Shanahan. Shanahan, his first year, he was terrible. I said, this is the best year he's had so far since he's been a coach. I was trying to psych myself and other Packers fans into actually believing that we had a chance. Like, I knew we didn't have a snowball chance in hell with beating the Niners. The Niners defense was just too much.
And then on top of that, yes, I know my 49ers lost the Super Bowl, but damn it, we got there. We only threw the ball 8 times.
Yes. That's what made it even worse. But damn it, you know I'm a fan, Brian. I'm a fan.
I know you are. I know you are a partner. I know you're a partner.
I was sticking with my heart. That was our heart.
And then a fella named Raheem Mostert showed up out of nowhere. And if I know you as well as I do, we've been friends a while. If I know you, brother, as well as I do, every time Raheem Mostert touched the ball, you're going, "Who the hell is this guy?"
Yes, I couldn't believe it. And that was the most frustrating part about the NFC Championship, Brian. It wasn't the fact that we lost. It was how we lost. I said, "How the hell did we lose a game? How did we lose a game?" And Jimmy G passed 8 times.
8 times.
Like, what? 8 times. Unbelievable.
I had so many friends at work. Come up to me, because you know folks know I go do the show and then I come home. I go to work. My wife and I go to work and then we come back and then I crank up and go. But I had so many friends at work come up to me, and I'm sitting here with tears in my eyes, and I'm going, my friends will say, "How did you know they were going to act that they were going to be that bad?" I mean, my friends were coming up to me at work, and they would just yank me aside and go, "How the hell did you know it was going to be that bad?"
Oh man, it was pretty embarrassing. Like, it was embarrassing. Like, I gotta be honest, I have never, like, I've been watching Packers games for years, bro. Yes. I've been a fan since I was 2 years old.
Yes, sir.
And I'm gonna be honest, I have never literally watched the game, especially since Aaron Rodgers has been our quarterback. I have never watched a game where the early part of that game, I said to myself, "Damn, Like we really, like I knew, like I got, I like early, the early part of the game, the early part of the game, bro. I don't really shit. Like, cause here I am. I put on my Packers gear, Brian. I put on my Packers shorts, my Packers jersey, my Packers socks, my hat. I'm a real fan. I put on all my gear.
I know it. I know it, man.
I was sitting there watching it.
I know it.
Yeah, and I was watching it like, man, these boys are getting blown off the ball. I said, they wasted my Sunday night, my Sunday evening. They got to go to work tomorrow. And they wasted my Sunday evening.
I told you my friends at work would just come up to me and they would just have this look on their face. There are a couple folks there that are big time Packer fans and they wore the hat and everything and they were trying to jinx me my last day there before I had my 2 days off. And then that Sunday I go in and they just looked at me. You know how your friends give you this look when you knew something they didn't? They just looked at me, dog. They just looked at me with this death stare. Like, how the hell did you pick this off? And I'm laughing the whole day. I'm laughing the whole time. One of my supervisors, you know it's bad when a supervisor approaches you. One of my supervisors came up to me and said, did you really expect them to score 37 points? Hell yeah. Oh man, it's Next Level Sports with Trey Larkins and yours truly, the Snowman. We're just having fun here on this premier edition, and folks, you're going to hear this also inside Snowman in the Morning. Man, listen, there are quite a few subjects where Trey and I pick at each other a lot. Aaron Rodgers is one, and I love the videos when you are in your Packer, when you're in your Packer garb. I'm glad y'all beat the Bears, even though the Bears are my hometown team. But I knew you had no shot in hell against the 49ers twice. And the first time we beat you, as I mentioned before, we were beat up. We didn't have everybody. NFC Championship, we were completely healthy, and you said, I don't care if y'all are completely healthy. We're going to beat you in the Bay. No, you're not.
It was rough, man, because like a lot of times when it comes to football, when you look at games from a defensive standpoint, you are actually okay if a quarterback drops back the pass and beats you with his arm. He throws for over 400 yards, 500 yards. Mm-hmm. But when you have a team that has over 200 rushing yards in a particular playoff game, like the 49ers, they literally snatched the Packers' defensive front hearts from their chest. Like they literally snatched their hearts from their chest, and it was a complete domination by that offensive line for the 49ers. They dominated the game in the trenches. Yeah. And it brought me back to old school football, Brian, to be honest, because this is what they did back in the 80s and the 90s. They were running the football.
We ran the football.
In playoff games. Exactly.
we ran the football, and the defensive line of the Packers, and I know you praised them and you had every reason to, they only got to Garoppolo once. And that was by luck. That was by pure unadulterated luck, and it led to a field goal, and at the time it put us up 10-0. And then the second quarter, it was y'all were buried in the dirt.
Exactly. And then, because I've said all year, I think that Za'Darius Smith and Preston Smith, they were great pickups for my Packers in the offseason.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they were.
I like both of those brothers.
Yes.
Yeah. But those guys, they're pass rushers. Mm-hmm. So coming into the game, I felt like if the game is close, if we can apply some pressure to Jimmy Garoppolo, may get some turnovers, you know, get some more opportunities for Aaron Rodgers. It never even got to that point.
Nope.
Because the Niners ran the football effectively. So Jimmy Garoppolo didn't even have to throw the ball more than eight times.
We ran the ball 44 times. You know why you didn't get to Garoppolo? We ran the ball 44 times. 42 times. I'm looking at the stats right now. My wife's pulling it up for me. 42 times we ran the ball in that game.
Definitely. And see, the thing is, when you play sports and you play a team in a regular season and then you play them in the playoffs, if you get beat in a regular season, you feel like when we get to the playoffs, it may be a different moment. You know, maybe we can outplay
Absolutely.
That team, whatever
Absolutely.
The case may be. But I got to be honest, this year It didn't matter if we played you guys in Green Bay, where you played in San Francisco, we played you at Paul Brown Stadium. In two games this year, when the Packers played the Niners, you guys have outscored us
74-28.
You're the better team. You're the best. And that's to be honest, a lot of times, I got to say this too real quick, Brian. A lot of times when it comes to football and like my Packers, when we lose a close playoff game, mm-hmm. I'd be devastated. Like right. Back in the 2014 NFC Championship game, yep. when we lost to Seattle,
yeah.
I was devastated. I felt like we should have won that. Yeah, I was devastated. And it's been other games where like we got beat. But this one wasn't really hard for me to get over after about a day because I just felt like, hey, the Niners were a better team than us. Period. Once you can accept that a team is better than your team,
yeah,
it helps you sleep better at night. It helps you sleep better.
It does.
It's hard when teams aren't as good as your team,
and they still beat you.
We were in the game. We had a chance. Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
and they still beat you. I tell you what, man. Like I told you, folks. He and I pick on each other a lot online. We do it in fun. And after the Sunday night game, I mentioned something to Trey about y'all are going to have nightmares about George Kittle if we see you again. And Trey immediately jumped on it, and I knew he would. He was like, nah, we're not going to have any problems with George Kittle. He only caught the ball once tonight. Yeah, problem is, it went for 61 yards and a touchdown.
Yeah, exactly.
It went for 60. Like, yeah, we only limited Kittle to one catch. Yeah, here's the problem. It went for 61 yards and a touchdown and basically put the game out of reach.
Exactly. Exactly. And you know what's so funny? In the NFC Championship game, Kittle didn't do much, but he didn't have to.
No.
He didn't have to. Yeah, he didn't have to. But that leads me to another conversation I want to ask you, Brian.
All right.
Speaking of George Kittle. Who do you believe is the best tight end in pro football?
It's a tie.
Kelce or Kittle?
It's a tie. It's a tie. Kelce because he won the Super Bowl. Kittle because he does everything. Kelce does everything also. I mean, the two of the best tight ends, and I think they're going to meet in Tampa next year. And, yes, I'm putting a very bold prediction out there. Look, there's not much difference between Travis Kelce and George Kittle. But the play of the year goes to Kittle with that play he made against New Orleans on 4th-and-2, where he dragged three Saints down the field with him for 30 yards.
Yes, and if you remember at that time, in that game, it was the Saints and the Niners that was fighting for home field advantage in the NFC.
Yeah.
So the Niners needed that game.
New Orleans was the number one seed at the time. The 49ers came in, they hung with the Saints, and it was 46-40. It was 46-45, and then magic happened on 4th-and-2. I couldn't believe that play. And here's another funny story for you. I was watching it. Wife and I were taking a nap, or trying to take a nap before we had to do a night shift at work. But I had to lay completely still and not shake the bed in excitement, so I wouldn't wake my wife up.
Yeah, that was a big-time play.
Like you said,
you could make an argument that was the play of the year. That was a hell of a play because the Niners needed that play. It was a 4th-and-2, and Garoppolo, he went through a security blanket and George Kittle. But I do agree with you about the comparison of George Kittle and Kelce. Both of those players are great players.
Man.
I believe that I think I'll give Kittle the slight edge as far as a –
and it's a very slight edge because Kelsey's learning to block better. Okay, Kelce has a few thousand yard seasons, but Kittle knows his role. Kittle knows his role. He's just recently become a pass catching tight end. Folks, I have the clip queued up. This is courtesy of Fox Sports, the New Orleans Saints and the San Francisco 49ers. Here's the situation. It was 4th-and-2. For San Francisco, they needed to convert this or the game was over as the Niners only had one timeout remaining. This is the play that Trey and I say is the play of the year. Again, courtesy of Fox Sports.
Garoppolo fires. It is caught. Still on his feet is Kittle with a big play. And the stiff arm, George Kittle. Flags fly. He's down to the 30.
I saw that and I went, what?
Yeah. Yeah.
I saw that and I went, Did he just do that?
Yeah, that was a big time play. That was definitely a big time play.
Now,
when it comes to that game, though,
yeah,
go ahead.
That was the game of the year.
That was a great game.
Forget the Super Bowl. That was the game of the year. Saints and the 49ers. Here's another thing that Trey and I pick on each other a lot about. Trey seems to think, and you know I'm doing this in fun, Trey seems to think that he knows the NBA point guard that has the best handles, but he always comes up with the wrong answer. He always seems to come. I tell you what, in the years that Trey and I have been friends, we have argued between Kyrie Irving and Stephen Curry for almost every NBA conversation that we've had online, man.
Yes, we have.
it's fun. It's fun when you can talk with someone and they pick on you and you pick on them right back. Trey made a post one day that caught my attention. And he says, I don't care what anybody says, Kyrie Irving has the best handles in the NBA. Argue with me. I was the first one that commented and said, okay, no problem. He doesn't. And I could just see Trey's face drop. He's laughing, but I see his face drop. And he's like, you dare argue against me? Hell yeah, I do, because I know someone that's got better handles than Kyrie Irving. And he says, who is that? I want you. He kept begging me, and I couldn't respond for a while because I was at work at the time. And he says, I dare you to tell me someone who has better handles than Kyrie Irving. Okay, he wears number 30. And he goes, you're kidding, right? Hell no, I'm not kidding. We've been friends since, and we've been arguing about that since that day.
Yeah, we have. I do agree with you that Steph Curry does have tremendous handles, but I think Kyrie Irving, in his own right, has great handles. I think those two are definitely top three.
I've always agreed with you that he does. But see, there's an advantage. See, Kyrie hit a championship-winning shot in 2016, and then a year later, Steph returned the favor after going behind his back and between his legs, nearly losing the dribble, and then he buried a three from the corner that sealed up game five a year later. So that cancels each other out.
Yeah, but you gotta also throw in there in that game when it shot by Kyrie, it was over Steph.
Yeah. So Steph returned the favor the next year over Kyrie after baking him with a dribble, and then he like launched another ridiculous shot, and he buried it from the corner.
Yeah. That actually leads me to another thing I wanted to ask you about Steph Curry. Yeah. I was listening to Steve Kerr, and Steve Kerr was talking about it's a possibility that Steph Curry may return to the lineup in March. Do you believe the Warriors should play Steph Curry this year,
no,
or do you think he should sit out the rest of the season?
No. Let him completely heal. Let Klay Thompson completely heal. Because they're going to have one of the top five draft picks, and they're going after a big man. They're going after a big man that can run the floor. In fact, I'll put a rumor out there right now. The Warriors acquired Andrew Wiggins for D'Angelo Russell. There is another piece from Minnesota that's in play, and that piece is Karl Anthony Towns.
Yeah. Yep, I've heard those rumblings. I agree with you about Steph Curry. I believe Steph, the Warriors, I don't care what they do, but they need to let Steph Curry know, hey, go home, be a family man, Aisha and the kids. You've had five straight
finals.
Five straight finals appearance. I believe at some point, there's wear and tear on your body. Mm-hmm. I believe Steph Curry should sit at home. I don't think the Warriors should even want him at the facility. He's been to the finals five straight years.
But see, Steph Curry is a shooter. Yes, Steph deserves time off. Klay deserves time off. That whole team deserves some time off. And this year, unfortunately, is that time off. But you know what's pissing them off? That they're not in contention for top seed in the West or a playoff spot in the West. But here's what I think is going to happen, and this is totally a rumor. This is totally my thoughts. Karl Anthony Towns is in play for the Golden State Warriors. Okay? There's a chance that not only Karl Anthony Towns returns, but D'Angelo Russell returns with him. Because now the Warriors have some draft capital to dangle in front of Minnesota. You get Karl Anthony Towns, and a lot has been made about his defense, or lack thereof, in Minnesota. He was playing defense under Tom Thibodeau, okay? You get Karl Anthony Towns in that system with Mike Brown coaching him, he will be so dynamite and so dangerous, and you're going to look up and see, wait a minute, where the hell do the Warriors come from? Again.
Yes, I agree with you. But here's the thing, though, Brian. Even without Karl Anthony Towns, anytime that you have Steph Curry
and Klay Thompson,
the best shooting backcourt we've ever seen. Ever. Anytime you have those two ever on the court together, guess what? The Warriors are a championship contender. You know it, and I know it. And I know you're a Warriors fan, but I know you love this.
Thank you. Somebody that agrees with what I'm feeling when it comes to the Golden State Warriors. There are three teams that I follow religiously: my hometown Bulls, the San Antonio Spurs, and the Golden State Warriors. And a lot of people seem to think I'm a bandwagon fan, but you know what? There were a fellow named Tim Hardaway, Chris Mullen, and Mitch Richmond that made me follow the Warriors back in the 90s. Then came the We Believe team with Steven Jackson and Baron Davis in 2007. I've been a full-time Warrior fan since 2007 with that We Believe team. Klay Thompson and Steph Curry are the best damn shooting backcourt, period.
Yes. 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 I completely agree with you. And if both of those guys come back healthy next year,
it's
the
trouble.
Warriors will definitely be championship picture.
It's trouble.
Right back in the championship picture. I've been telling everybody this for weeks about the Warriors. I said this year, they're taking a year off.
That's all they're doing. Because people are still buying up tickets to the Chase Center. In a heartbeat. And you know what made my year for as far as covering the Warriors? They beat the Houston Rockets in the Chase Center on Christmas Day.
Yes, they did. And I said, when that happened, I said, this is inexcusable for the Rockets. I said, anytime James Harden is in the Bay, he always comes up short. Like, he never gets it done when he plays the Warriors in Golden State. Now, it never happens. He had horrors and nightmares at Oracle Arena. Now he's having nightmares
at Chase Center.
He had nightmares in Oakland.
He's having bigger nightmares in San Francisco because the loss in San Francisco was minus the Splash Brothers.
Exactly. Exactly. It's unbelievable. It's crazy. Let me ask you a question, too, about...
Go for it.
Go ahead, Brian. My bad. Go ahead.
What's your question? Go for it.
I was going to say... When it comes to the NBA overall, we know we're about to get back into the second half of the season. And, you know, so far, the Lakers are the leaders in the West and the Eastern Conference is the Bucks. Who is your favorite right now to be in the NBA Finals? Who you got winning it?
I feel like Kawhi with that laugh. But anyway.
Did you just give up your answer?
Clippers. Clippers. Raptors.
Raptors. Wow,
Raptors.
Interesting. Okay. Wow. Well, let's start off in the Western Conference. I agree with you. I think the Clippers will be in the Western Conference Finals against the Lakers, but I have the Clippers beating the Lakers in the Western Conference Finals because
the Lakers won't even see the Western Conference Finals.
Really? You don't have them in there?
I'll borrow one of your answers that I love saying a lot. Hell no!
Okay, so who do you have beating the Lakers in the playoffs? Yeah. Do you think the Rockets could get them?
Once again, hell no. The team that will take out the Lakers will be the Denver Nuggets.
The Nuggets, interesting. Yeah, because right now, the way the standings are, the Nuggets are the second seed. I think the Clippers are going to be the second seed when it's all said and done in the Western Conference. We shall see.
Hey, crazy. Yeah. It's the Western Conference. You know crazy things happen in the Western Conference.
It'll be the second half of the year,
and the most stupid things happen in the Western Conference second half of the year. Even during Golden State's run, stupid things happen. Just ask the Houston Rockets. They won 65 games 2 years ago and got spanked at home in Game 7.
Yes, they did. But right now, when you look at the standings, if it stays the way it's currently constructed, the Nuggets will play the Clippers in the second round.
Yep.
I think the Clippers will beat the Nuggets. Yeah, I think the Clippers will beat the Nuggets. And in the second round, the Lakers would play either the Jazz or the Rockets. Jazz and the Rockets are in that 4 or 5 spot.
Okay.
I'll say
Utah takes out the Lakers.
I can't go that far.
I'm going that far, and I got a very good reason. This is where Next Level Sports Talk comes in, folks. I got a very good reason. The Lakers do not have a point guard.
Completely agree with you. Completely agree with you. You know what's so funny, Brian? Yesterday, I was on Twitter, and all of a sudden I get a notification to my phone. Oh, Reggie Jackson reaches a buyout with the Detroit Pistons. He's expected to sign with the Lakers. No, not the Lakers, the Clippers. I said, mm-hmm. What? The Lakers should have been trying to get Reggie Jackson. Like, are you kidding me? Like,
the Lakers should have been trying to get Derrick Rose.
Yeah, Derrick Rose too. But even if you can't get Derrick Rose, they could have at least got Reggie Jackson. Reggie Jackson can create his own shot. Mm-hmm. He's a facilitator. He's a playmaker. I think he could have helped the Lakers. You remember they were trying to get Darren Collison.
Yeah, Darren Collison took a look at that dumpster fire and went, "Hell no, I don't want a part of that."
Yeah, exactly. But that actually leads me to my other point about why I agree with you that the Clippers will beat the Lakers. I don't know if it'll be in the Western Conference Finals, but I think the Clippers are going to be representing the West in the finals because the Clippers, if they do play the Lakers, they got 4 players they can send to guard LeBron James, Paul George, Kawhi Leonard, Morris, and Patrick Beverly.
And they won't need all 4 of them. They'll just tell the claw, sick them. They'll tell the claw to sick them.
But the thing is, Brian, they don't even need Kawhi to guard LeBron, to be
right.
honest. Kawhi can save his energy for the offensive end.
Yep.
And that really is going to be problems for the Lakers because other than LeBron James, they have no other playmakers on their team.
None. They nearly got beat by the Denver Nuggets before the All-Star break, and that took overtime.
Yes, it did. And like I said, I disagree with you. I think the Lakers will get to the Western Conference Finals because I do think LeBron James and Anthony Davis as a duo will be a little bit too much for the Jazz, and if they had to play like the Grizzlies or the Mavericks in the first round, I think they'll be a little bit too much for those teams. Mm-hmm. But they'll lose to the Clippers in the Western Conference Finals for sure.
Semifinals is as far as the Lakers will go. Okay, it's the Western Conference. It's really going to depend on who gets what seed. Speaking of seeds, I'm going to make a very bold prediction. The team that gets the number 8 seed and that will give the Lakers the business in the first round before eventually being eliminated will be the Portland Trailblazers.
I agree with you. I think the way Damian Lillard is playing, I know he had the injury before the All-Star break. I think the injury is growing.
Yeah.
And that's not good. Yeah.
No, it's not.
Yeah. That's not good. But if Damian Lillard comes back and he's anywhere close to 100%, I don't see there's any way in hell that Damian Lillard doesn't get the Trailblazers into the playoffs. I think it's going to happen. And I agree with you. I think the Lakers will probably win that series against the Trailblazers,
yep.
But it'll be a tough 6 games.
Portland's going to give the Lakers the business, and I wouldn't be surprised if it goes the distance. I would not be surprised if LeBron gets taken the distance by the Portland Trailblazers in the first round. Now, as for the Eastern Conference, can we please just shut it down that the Philadelphia 76ers are not getting to the Eastern Conference Finals? Can we shut that down, please?
Yes, because I believe, especially if they stay right now, they're in the 5th spot. So they'll play Miami in the first round. They'll lose to Miami. Miami will beat the Sixers.
Everybody in the East can give the Sixers the business for the simplest of reasons. Philadelphia can't win on the road.
Yes, they're terrible on the road. 9-19 on the road. They're 25-2 at home. Mm-hmm. They're 9-19 on the road. Let me ask you a question. Do you believe that Brett Brown is the coach for the Sixers moving forward? Do you think he's going to be the coach to get them to the next level?
No.
Me either. I don't think so either.
But the only way Brett Brown stays is if either Ben Simmons or Joel Embiid takes a hike. And I think Ben Simmons is going to take a hike.
Yes, I agree. Because the problem we have with Brett Brown, he doesn't develop his players well.
No, nope.
We talked about all season long, about whether or not Ben Simmons is going to be able to hit consistent jump shots. Brian doesn't even take jump shots. He's not even taking a jump shot. Like, what do you do? Like,
why is he so afraid to take a jump shot? Why is he so afraid to take a jump shot?
But that's coaching, Brian. That's coaching, because your coach has to let you know we need you to hit consistent jump shots. And what you've been working on in the gym, that's all we needed Ben Simmons to work on if you're a Sixers fan, was hitting consistent jump shots.
Not only that, but hitting some free throws. He's a lefty. Yes. Not only that, hitting some free throws. Because if you notice, the last two series Philadelphia was in, he was sitting on the bench in crunch time. Because if he's on the floor in the final 4 minutes of the fourth quarter, they're going to foul the hell out of him. Go to the line and make some free throws.
Yeah, you got to hit your free throws. And the thing is, half the time when I'm watching Joel Embiid, I like Joel Embiid. I think Joel Embiid has tremendous upside, and he can be a superstar. But half the time when I'm watching Embiid, Brian, he's out of shape. He's out of shape. He's tired going up and down the floor. He doesn't have that motor that the Greek Freak has, and he's going to need that for the Sixers to win in the playoffs.
Embiid doesn't have that motor, and I'll tell you someone else who doesn't have that motor and won't have it for a couple of years. That's Zion Williamson. Have you seen him go up and down the floor? I'm not impressed.
So you think he needs to lose some weight, too? Do you think that'll help his game?
And he's playing. Does he need to lose some weight, I think he's playing out of position.
So you don't think he... Because what they got him playing like the five, right? He plays a lot of five? Yep.
They need to pull him out. Need to pull him out of the post, make him lose about 40 pounds, and then make him shoot about 100 jump shots, 100 jump shots an hour. I think Zion Williamson needs to be a shooting guard.
Really?
I think Zion needs to be... I look at it this way. I'll give you a perfect example. There's a fellow named Charles Barkley who's in the Hall of Fame, known as the round mound of rebound for many reasons. In Philadelphia, he was this big man that lumbered up and down the floor. Now, he had a completely different motor than Zion Williamson. That's why I love watching Barkley play. But at the same time, when Barkley was traded from Philadelphia to Phoenix, you know how much weight he lost to really get himself in shape to run in the Western Conference? How do you think he won the MVP in 1993? And not only that, he added something very, very important. A consistent jump shot from long range.
Yes. I agree with you about that. I understand where you're coming from that standpoint. I think overall, though, this year, they were talking about on First Take earlier, who's the rookie of the year? It's by far John Morant. John Morant
was rookie of the year getting off the bus.
Yes. He's having a hell of a year.
John Morant was the rookie of the year getting off the train station before he was selected.
Yes.
John Morant came ready. All right? John Morant was ready.
This year, he's averaging 18 points per game on 49% shooting, 7 assists per game. So, John Morant is a great facilitator. He's a tremendous playmaker, and he is changing the culture in Memphis. Memphis has something with this John Morant kid.
Yeah.
Yes, they have something.
It's the return of the grindhouse.
I've been seeing all these people talk about, well, maybe Zion can find himself in the rookie of the year conversation.
No.
This is John Morant award right now, and I'm pretty sure it's going to finish the year that way. He's been playing some great basketball.
Man, please. I love John Morant. Loved watching him at Murray State. He's only gotten better. And besides, whenever you hit a three-pointer in James Harden's eyes, in James Harden's face, you have my vote.
Yes, for certain. I want to get back to the Eastern Conference real quick. And I want to talk about the Bucks, because, you know, last year the Bucks were the number one overall seed in the Eastern Conference, lost in the Eastern Conference Finals to Kawhi and the Raptors.
Yep.
This year, they're the number one overall seed again.
Mm-hmm.
And
they're going to lose again.
They're playing some.
No. I don't trust the Bucks to get out of the East. Because all you have to do to beat the Bucks is do what Toronto did. Send a posse after Giannis. And I mean that defensively.
Yeah, I agree with you. I've been seeing everyone riding this Milwaukee Bucks to the finals train. And I believe the Milwaukee Bucks. Yeah, I know, but everybody else is. All the experts, they predicting the Bucks could be in the finals. I disagree completely. I think the Bucks could lose to the Miami Heat in the second round. Mm-hmm. I really do.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I'm not a sole believer in the Bucks, and here's one of the reasons why. The Greek Freak, he doesn't have any consistent moves on the offensive side of the ball. Like when it's time to make a move and the game is late, and all games in the playoffs are close games. And you have to be a player that can create his own shot,
right,
to get to a certain point on the floor, get to the free throw line. Those are the issues that I have with the Greek Freak. He obviously doesn't hit consistent jump shots. And one of the problems that I have with his game, offensively, he struggles. He struggles overall being able to get to his spot, like a Kawhi Leonard, like a Kevin Durant when he was playing, you know, before his injury. He struggles being able to get to a certain spot and hit a shot that he can rely on in a playoff series. And that could be some issues for the Bucks the later they get into the playoffs.
And here's something, we'll close with this. Here's something I've said about Giannis Antetokounmpo, even though he's added a jump shot, it's not consistent. I've said four words about Giannis since he's been in the league. Giannis Antetokounmpo can't shoot.
He can't shoot. And, like, I believe in a playoff series, if they're going up against the Miami Heat, the way Jimmy Butler is playing,
it's trouble.
And Leonard Nelson, it's trouble. And now they actually have Andre Iguodala and Jay Crowder, two players who can help the Miami Heat defensively.
Yeah, one of them who's won three world championships. This is the indictment. Exactly. We'll leave with this note before we head to break. I'll leave with this note. This is an indictment against the Los Angeles Lakers. Two of them. You had two All-Stars and one three-time champion. The three-time champion being Andre Iguodala, the All-Stars, both Iguodala and Derrick Rose. And they got neither of them. Oops.
Neither.
Oops.
Yeah. Neither of them. It made no sense. Like, they didn't make no moves. Like, I didn't understand it for the life of me. And I said, with Marcus Morris going to the Clippers, the Lakers, if anything, said just trade it for him to keep him away from the Clippers. If anything, just do something to keep him away from the Clippers.
But
they didn't do it.
Who's in charge? Who's in charge? Rob frickin' Pelinka.
Yep. It's Rob Pelinka.
There's the prop. There's the problem. Rob Pelinka ain't nowhere near Jerry Buss.
He's not.
There's the problem, Laker Nation. There's your problem. As soon as you clean up your front office, you can actually make some moves that actually work. And I wouldn't be surprised that in 2 years' time, Anthony Davis says, I'm the hell out of here. If not earlier.
Me either. Yes, that's what people are saying. And you know he's from Chicago, and the All-Star game was in Chicago this year. And I wouldn't be surprised if
the Bulls made a play for him in the offseason, in this coming offseason, if the Bulls didn't make a play for him.
Yes, I agree with you. I definitely could see the Bulls pursuing Anthony Davis. He's from Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
He's lived in that area. So if the Lakers come up short in the playoffs and they have an early playoff exit,
the Bulls are making a move.
See Anthony Davis. Yeah, we could possibly see Anthony Davis looking over at Chicago and wondering if he could go over there and help that team.
Mm-hmm.
And so we'll see what happens. Mm-hmm. We'll definitely see what happens.
And we'll leave LeBron in the dust again. Next Level Sports Talk, you can hear it each week with yours truly, the Snowman, and Trey Larkins. And Trey, a pleasure, my man. An absolute joy.
Yes, sir. I definitely agree with you on that. I'm excited about it. I love doing this with you, man. It's going to be fun. It's definitely going to be some fun time moving forward.
It is going to be fun. Thanks a lot, my friend.
Yes, sir. I appreciate it. You have a good one.
I couldn't think of a better way to close out this show than to have my buddy Trey Larkins on. We have been talking about getting together and doing a segment that's actually going to become a separate show. We're in the process of putting it together, but we have been talking about it for a while, and it's wonderful. It's wonderful to have him on, And that'll put a wrap on this one. Until next time, have a great day. God bless. Remember to make your next move your best move. And always remember, if your dreams don't scare you, then they are not big enough. Dream big, do bigger. I am, and I hope y'all are too. Till tomorrow, Snowman out.